gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barndominium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure, and he just dives in!
Bradford.
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home. Inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Signarama Studios, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks. Signarama, West Columbia, South Carolina. Signarama.com. Served by Chicken Cock Bourbon, always. And built by the Barndominium Co., the Barndominium Co.com. Golly, their floor plans just continue to amaze everybody. That's one of, they're one of the nation's best builders. The Barndo Co. is what they're called. If you're going to build a home, make it your dream home. The Barndominium Co.com. Schubert, Mad Dog, and myself, JB, here until 2 o'clock today. Mike Morgan in at noon. John Whittle in at 11:20. Gamecocks take 2 of 3 from the Gators in Gainesville this weekend. A full profile coming up on Carolina baseball. Plus, it's spring game week. Carolina is the last SEC team, I think, to complete their spring practice with a 7 o'clock kickoff at Williams-Brice Stadium under the lights, weather permitting. Some rain right now in the forecast, but that can all change drastically. It's going to be a warm week across the Palmetto State, as a matter of fact. And a huge weekend, big Gamecock weekend is upon us. Not number one anymore, but Arkansas will be in town, and you can call them number one if you'd like to. They will be number two after dropping a pair at Alabama this weekend. But at the end of the day, it is still going to be a huge, huge series for South Carolina. And then the following week, the Kentucky Wildcats will be in town. They're number three in the nation. 30-5. Wow. It's just been incredible. Some commitment news. South Carolina has been reeling them in. JC can fill us in on all of that. And, of course, hats off to Scotty Scheffler for winning the Masters. Only 8 players under par this weekend, guys. Of course, played incredibly difficult. Tiger did finish last, but made the cut. And he has now played 100 rounds. At that golf course, which is just crazy to even think about. With all that said, hope y'all had just a magical, wonderful weekend. I've got to say something. My daughter Hannah made the first out for the Kiss City Cafe Cardinals this weekend. So proud of her. Nobody else could figure out that, you know, when they pick the ball up and throw it to first, you get it, and then you run over and touch first, and if the runner hasn't gotten there, he or she is out. Hannah figured it out. And so hats off to my daughter, Hannah, for making the first out of the year. It was a Hall of Fame moment as a father. Now I understand what all other dads have gone through when their kids play T-ball and you coach them the right way and you do things the right way. And, just keep doing it the right way. It's going to happen. And it finally happened. So that was the big accolade at the Bradford household this weekend. Hannah makes an out.
Nice. You got to love when the game clicks for the game slows down.
Man. Yeah. Man, I was so proud, man. I was so proud. The smile on her face was just awesome. It was so cool. So There you go. Way to go, Hannah James. She rocked it. What's up, JC? Where's your heart going? Where was it?
It's National Titanic Remembrance Day.
It's a national day for everybody.
No, see, all right, so I'm doing these little cartoons like for the show, for the thumbnail and the social. I'm doing these little cartoons every day, and I'm going to do a different one every day. That's my goal. However many shows
I was wondering what inspired today's. Okay.
And I was like, so I look it up, and so it's all, there's always like four national days. It's also National Purple Day.
It's Tax Day.
That's Tax Day. It's National Be Yourself Day. And then one other one, like some kind of food. And I always try to pick the most obscure one that can fit into the cartoon. So on today's little show logo and thumbnail, and you can see it on Instagram, Twitter, and at the top of the show, it's kind of like our curtain that we pull back. There's the Titanic with a gigantic Gamecock on the front. Yeah. Now, let's hope that doesn't mean anything.
I was about to say, I don't know that
that's not the maybe not the best choice. You know,
what about like the Nina and the Pinta and the Santa Maria? Didn't they make it across the
Atlantic? Yeah, they actually made it. So I don't know, man. It's just I thought it was cool, and then you know, of course, that song from the movie "My Heart Will Go On" by Celine Dion.
Well, hats off to one of my best friends, Mike Sisko. It's National Glazed Spiral Ham Day. So all
yes, I thought about that too.
Honey baked ham in Somerville, South Carolina, and get your goodness from the former Gamecock right hander. How about that? Quick plug for him. He's the jerk that comes out and you know doesn't smile and
throws you your hand.
Thank you. Yeah. He's the guy. He's like you know the occasional fast food worker who isn't happy to be there. They just kind of toss the food at you. Yeah, it's him. He's such a
man. The people of the honey baked ham here, like they act like they're doing you a favor when you walk out the store, and they are because it's so delicious. I mean,
that's right.
You could be they know like what the they soup got.
Yeah,
you could be like the soup Nazi with honey baked ham if you wanted to be. No ham for you.
Sure.
Man, that makes a good split pea soup after a while too. If you put the
absolutely in
the get it out, make you some soup on it. Oh man, God,
yeah.
Anyway, I got some ham in there. I'm sorry, what I'm having for lunch? A nice ham sandwich. So
yeah, absolutely, man. I'm with you. Some Duke's mayo on top. Ooh,
nice some fresh tomato. Roll. Yeah, that's something else. So anyway, yeah, I had a good weekend. You know, we watched the Gamecock baseball team twice, and Saturday kind of hung out with some friends, and then Sunday our mailbox fell down.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah, it's split in half. Like, you know, I think the snowplow got it a couple months ago, so we've had our mailbox sitting in a trash can surrounded by bricks, and so I dug a hole and put concrete, so we got the new mailbox going up. So that was exciting, and we went to see the kid's grandfather. He's getting knee replacement surgery, so we hung out in the nursing home and watched the Masters, and then put a mailbox in the ground. So that was my Sunday. So nothing too terribly exciting around Casa de Sherbert. I get on the bird tomorrow and fly to Columbia, so that's I'll be at Studio South and on my laptop. So bear with me sound wise for the rest of the week. I don't think I can plug my mic into my laptop. So, but I'm going down. I'm going to be at the Big Spur golf tournament. Hope to see all of you there and all that good stuff.
Yeah. If you haven't signed up for that, head to thebigspur.com and you can, there's definitely a link on the message boards. It's pinned at the top. It's 1 week from today. It's a 9 a.m. shotgun. Nana Sports will be serving lunch. There will be a silent auction as well, and it'll be played out at Fort Jackson. It's neat. Always neat. If you've never played Fort Jackson, always neat to play at Fort Jackson because you'll hear some folks off at the firing range from time to time, and you'll see some choppers and things like that kind of sporting around. So you're able to tip your cap to the U.S. military while you're there playing around the golf, and really looking forward to that. John Whittle has worked his rear end off, as he does with everything in his life, on putting this together once again. So excited to play in that, and hope to meet many of you out there. And hope you're playing. Again, it's on thebigspur.com. That's the website that is owned by one J.C. Schubert, whose heart will go on, according to his screen today here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Anything, I know we did get a we got plenty of baseball coming, and I'll try to save as much of this to have with John, a full profile in South Carolina. Anything, JC, that you can share on the commitment front for Gamecock football? I know Coach Beamer last night let the world know that somebody else has jumped into the Garnet and Black boat. Cannot hear you.
Muted
you
there, JC. Muted. Yeah, man.
I think somebody everybody's going to like. I think there was a crystal ball put in right after that. So I'm not going to reveal any state secrets, but let's just say hypothetically it is that Kendall Daniels guy from Norfolk, Virginia. Number one, I said it all the time, it's a place you need to go recruit. The 757 Tidewater, whatever. Number two, when you start to kind of look at safety down the road, okay, so you got Nick Emanuore, kind of a longer guy. Kilgore's got some length to him, even though he's not as tall. Really, DQ Smith, too. I mean, they're all kind of – and if you look through Torian Gray's career, he's done it with both. I mean, guys like D'Angelo Hall weren't particularly tall, but they were great. And then – also, guys like Jimmy Williams and Cam Chancellor in the secondary at Virginia Tech that he coached were outstanding, and they were monsters. So he's got a track record with monsters, right?
Yeah.
And you look at this class with the say you look at Leach and the length that that guy's got, and then you if you get this kid, he's another 6'3", 190-pound guy that will knock your manhood in the dirt.
Yeah.
Physical. And now that's why I love kids at 757. They're like Miami kids, South Florida kids. They love you don't have to worry about them loving football at all. And they love the physicality of it. That's, you want to look back through Frank Beamer's career and how did he come up with all these athletes that would destroy you on defense? Even though they weren't heavily recruited, his pipeline from 757 to Blacksburg was something special. And I've always believed under Shane that South Carolina needs to get into Virginia. Virginia and Virginia Tech are not. They rarely keep guys at home. They didn't really during Frank Beamer's era either, because those schools are kind of so isolated and far away from really just about everywhere in the state. So there's a chance, you know, and they got Fred Johnson this past time and, you know, had a good shot at that receiver that stayed home. But, hey, now you got this guy, if that's the guy. And, you know, you pair him with Leach, and then they really like Kelvin Hunter that they got out of West Florence, who's a baller for this class. So, mm-hmm. You know, and when you look at recruiting, you look down the road, and as much as I gripe and complain about people griping and complaining about D-tackle recruiting, I'll have to kind of admit to you guys that y'all are right in doing that, because that's what you want to do, is look for this class down the road. Too often, like in the past, before we had great recruiting coverage, people would just look at it in terms of next year. Well, we need this next year. Well, you guys are looking 2 years down the road. So kudos to you for that, even though it annoys me sometimes. But when you look down the road at safety now, you kind of see, and then there's another kid. Gosh, his name escapes me. I had it written down, Christopher something, out of Georgia, that they're in on. And I don't know how many safeties, DBs, they're going to take this year. But he's another 6'3.5", 6'4" kid that looks really good. So, you know, that's, if you can get those kind of guys that can play, you know, not all of those tall guys can play, but if you can get those kind of guys that can play, it's a big advantage for your secondary. I mean, look, Nick Emanuore had some unfortunate moments in coverage last year, but you saw the interception against Clemson. I think he had one against Kentucky too, didn't he? I mean, you saw the big old Paul going up there and knocking things away. That's length. That's very beneficial. Hatfield, Christopher Hatfield. Thanks. Yeah, I knew it was a familiar name. And Clint also mentions Jadon Blair from North Carolina. So South Carolina could have a pretty good group of safeties in this class to go along with the kid from West Florence that they got, Kelvin Hunter, that they got from last year. So that's if it is this kid, it's a big pickup. If it's not, and I'll just leave that there, then who else could it be? You know, who knows? But I think that it's good that recruiting starting to pick up. I also think for those that were concerned, myself included, and I wasn't concerned. I was just like, well, you know, there's not a lot of momentum right now. You know, getting any kind of out-of-state blue chipper, if it is this kid, and you beat the home team, Virginia Tech, You beat Virginia, who thought they had a good shot at him, and you beat Penn State. And he also had offers from Alabama and some other schools too. So this is a guy with a legit resume from two states away. After a 5-7 season, that's pretty doggone good recruiting, I would think.
Well, and JC, it's spring game week, and I mentioned this Friday, but I guess we'll have hail tomorrow, I think. But throughout the week, the Big Spur will continue to compile a list of prospects that will be in. I know there's at least 2 5-star prospects that will be on campus this weekend, but there's going to be a ton of players, both on officials and unofficials, correct?
Oh, absolutely. And, I would, Shamari Earls, I have not seen the list to see if he'd be in, but there's a corner from Virginia that they're really, I think they lead for right now. But yeah, absolutely. There'll be, I think Zayden Walker's in, David Sanders is in for his official visit. Who knows what other top guys they will have. And I think that's a positive. Anytime you get a big group in, that's good. Like I said, they didn't have the momentum to start this cycle that they did last cycle, where, guys like Smith and Gregory and Pringle and Thompson, really, they were done. I mean, it was done by the time they got to January. Well, now you got to do a little more sales, because kids aren't as sure, and there's more NIL stuff out there than ever. And, you got to make sure. So I think that you got to see some light at the end of the tunnel as far as that goes. I want to say one more thing about the transfer portal, because I think it opened back up today.
Tomorrow.
There is still an SEC rule, in case you were, because I think everybody's kind of afraid, because I think Alabama's got 13 spots or so open, and they're going to be aggressive. There's still an SEC rule. You can't go from SEC school to SEC school during the second portal opening. Right. So in case you're concerned, Kalen DeBoer was going to come raid the Gamecock roster, or Kirby Smart or whoever, because Georgia, LSU, and Bama all have spots, is my understanding, and Texas A&M as well. Don't be afraid, because the rules are going to make it tough for anybody to go SEC to SEC right now. So, of course, you never know. They may get sued, but that'll change. But that's kind of the long and short of it there. I know that in the back of just some fans I've talked to, their minds, they kind of had their eye, the ones that follow recruiting closely, kind of had their eye on Bama. Josh Pate said something about teams' rosters getting completely raided the other day, and he's kind of tight around the SEC and stuff, but there won't be any SEC on SEC violence this time around.
It is 11:19. It is Monday. We are 1 week, as I mentioned, away from the 2024 Big Spur Golf Tournament. And John Whittle is putting all that together. TheBigSpur.com to register your foursome if you would like to participate, have some fun with a bunch of Gamecocks, some really neat auction items as well. I'll ask John about that because he's coming up next. So we'll hit a quick timeout. ITG, we'll be right back.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com. A tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me, I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you're gone.
I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm I'm a lover, wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
And we welcome you to Founders Park. It's time for baseball, folks. That ball rid the right and deep and gone. Swinging a drive. Left field, way back and gone. Lifts the ball into the air the opposite way. Has he done it twice? Yes, he has.
Taylor to the wall.
There's a high drive. That ball is tagged. That ball is way out of here. A grand slam home run for Ethan Petrie. What else can this young man do, Derek? My goodness, that ball was killed.
This is Ethan Petrie from Gamecock Baseball. You are now listening to Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Be loud. No Gamecocks.
Presented by Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com.
Mm-hmm. Be loud, Ethan Petrie asks. And that environment that you just saw from the balls that he hit out against LSU last year shouldn't be anything less with the second-ranked Arkansas Razorbacks coming to town on Friday at Founders Park. This weekend, Gamecocks have a opportunity, another one at home, to make a big, big, big stamp in the SEC. Isn't that right, John Whittle? They went on the road to Gainesville this weekend and took two of three from the Gators, who you could tell yesterday they've got talent. They've just been struggling this weekend. Maybe that win will get them going. I don't know. But South Carolina's right in the thick of it. And these next two weekends, I mean, if you are a fan of Carolina baseball, honestly, what else do you want? You got two of the best three teams in the country walking into your ballpark the next two weekends. So this is what it's all about. April, May, this time of the year, when you get to play these type of games in big-time environments, and it shouldn't be anything less than exceptional starting Friday night at Founders Park.
Yeah, absolutely. And big weekend this weekend, obviously, with the spring game happening. So fans should be in town and around. Florida, this past weekend, they had their spring game, and they had their second highest attended baseball weekend in program history this past weekend. So, you know, they showed that, when you're in town for the spring game, you can come around and hang around for a little baseball too. South Carolina's playing better here as of late and taking advantage of some opportunities. So get out there and see a couple of top 15 teams in the country out there playing. Top 20 teams anyway.
Yeah. Second, you mentioned the second most fans in a weekend ever at Florida. The first most was last time South Carolina came to town, last year in the Super Regional. So the Gamecocks have brought the folks out, and Gainesville would be nice to bring their own fans out this weekend. So I kind of, I stepped, I, I stepped over the line this morning, John. I was doing a bunch of research, and I said, you know what? I'm just going to put all this stuff on the Big Spur. So that's your space, and I apologize for doing that. But I kind of put together a profile for people to look at to kind of understand, like, no matter what you read on Twitter sometimes or the random dude in the message boards that wants to fire everybody and burn the whole thing down, actually, Carolina's in a pretty good spot. And, you know, if the season ended today, John, based on if you go back to the April 3rd D1 baseball postseason projections and you fast forward, you'd have to imagine Carolina would probably be a top 16, maybe 14 to 16 somewhere in there. If not, they're definitely knocking on the door. Florida's played their way out of that conversation, and some other teams around the country have. Kentucky's moved up. Vandy's kind of hanging around. But, you know, like you said, look, they've got things they still have to keep working through. We'll get to some of the individuals here in just a moment. But at the end of the day, they're still right here. They've got an RPI of 15. They're 8-7 in the league. They're 25-11 overall. They've got a hell of a resume, much like they did last year. And they're trying to put their foot down on the gas pedal and be one of the top 16 teams in the country so they can play at home.
Yeah, absolutely, and I've said a few times here lately that the eyeball test and the actual resume just haven't been very comparable for South Carolina up to this point. Now the eyeball is starting to catch up to the resume; it's starting to look a little bit better, at least offensively. You know, I think there are a few question marks from a pitching standpoint that have cropped up here lately. But you know, it even when South Carolina wasn't playing great ball, they've never played themselves out of it, and you know they've kept themselves in position, and you know, winning games like North Carolina and being able to salvage a game in a series loss has been you know, very beneficial for you know, keeping themselves in that conversation. Like LSU is out of things right now because you know they can't hold on to a lead against Tennessee and they get swept, and you know, things like that. So South Carolina's kept itself in position the entire way. And, you know, now you have 5 weekends left. 3 of them are at home. You've got a couple of opportunities, a couple of better opportunities to win some series. And, you know, now's the time to really start playing your best baseball.
All right, here are some of those numbers, by the way. Carolina has 9 quad one victories this year. That's the third most in college baseball. Their strength of schedule is 14th. They're 2-4 versus the RPI top 10, and they're 6-6 versus the RPI top 25. They've got a road / neutral record of 7-7, and their road series record is 1-2. All of those are quad one series away from Founders Park. Just 4 SEC teams have played a more difficult schedule thus far than South Carolina. Auburn, who's not in the postseason. Ole Miss, who, if things go right, they could be on the bubble. They've got some nice series wins. They just haven't been consistent. The Gators, who, believe it or not, at 18-17 today would still be in. And Alabama, who's certainly in and fighting to host. You got quad one opportunities left against Arkansas at home, Kentucky at home, Georgia at home. That's it. RPI 11 are the dogs. And then, they got to go to Tennessee to wrap up the season. They go to Missouri. It's a quad two chance. East Tennessee and at Winthrop, quad three. And then tomorrow night down here in the low country, they've got the Citadel. That's a quad four. Dogs have, when I say had injury issues, wow, have they had injury issues. It is wild what they've been through. You know, it's all there in front of them. And then you've got, with these next two series at home, if you win both of those, John, I mean, it goes without saying South Carolina is one of the teams everybody will be talking about. All right, on that team, let's start with the good. Let's go to the offense. Still had some issues with runners on base this weekend, as we saw. They had a couple big knocks late in the game yesterday, a little bit too little, too late. Dalton Reeves. I mean, so we could talk about the home runs, and that's fine because they matter, and the doubles, and that's fine because they matter, John. I don't think he struck out this weekend. It's the quality of at bat that this kid is giving this team. He's seeing pitches. He's fighting pitches. He's hit some sack flies. He's gotten bunts down. Whatever they ask him to do, he's doing it. What have you seen from him, and what have you learned about what took him so long to get into the?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you nailed it. That's the thing with Dalton is every time he's been in there, like he has a general idea of what needs to be done. He has a great feel for what's going on in the game and how he needs to approach an at bat. And you know, that's something that a lot of these guys in the lineup have not had for a lot of this season. Dalton just has an approach up there with the situation at hand. He knows how to adjust from at bat to at bat and in at bat. So, I mean, I really love what he's doing, and I thought he should have been in there each day for as a starter. You know, I think that's certainly going to be the case going forward. And I mean, it's just something that he's just gotten progressively better as time has gone along. I mean, he was okay in the fall. He was okay in the spring, and you know, he was never really a threat, you know, defensively to really try to steal some innings. But, you know, offensively, he's been certainly really good. They had some guys coming into the season who they thought were going to be really good and better than him. And so he's just been behind some guys and had to work his way through. And, you know, sometimes you get an opportunity and take advantage of it. And, mm-hmm. you know, that's what he's done. And, you know, maybe it's a little bit later in the year than like Ethan Petrie's last year or Kennedy Jones's earlier this year. But, you know, he's gotten his chance and he's making the most of it. And he's not going to be coming out of the lineup for a little while.
Yeah, well, he didn't catch because there's an All-American back there who leads the country in runs saved. His name is Cole Messina. And when he got moved to the leadoff spot on Friday, I kind of smiled. I sent Coach Lake a text. I said, really? They're going to lead off Messina. All right. It worked. He had his best weekend by far. I know he was 6 of 13 at the plate, but John, the walks, the amount of pitches that he would see in at bats. I mean, he was having quality, real at bats that we've expected Cole Messina to have really since day one this year. That's what I saw on TV, at least. What did you see sitting above him down in Gainesville?
Yeah. I mean, I had a big piece on Wednesday kind of looking at things offensively. And, you know, one thing Monty Lee talked about when he got here is a hitter profile. You're either a buffalo or a deer. And obviously a buffalo is a big old dude who's gonna try to put a hurting on the baseball and be big and strong. And a deer is going to be a guy who's going to, you know, manipulate the bat and use his speed and you know, hit some line drives and that kind of deal. And, you know, the reason I bring that up is I wrote in there, you know, I don't know what Cole Messina is. He's either a big old buck or a deer who can dodge a lion or something like that. I don't remember what it was, but he's a great mix of power and speed and athleticism. And I think that Cole fits fine in that leadoff role because he can do a lot of things really well. And, you know, he's going into the weekend, him and Talmadge LaCroix were down there, you know, kind of battling for least production with runners in scoring position. So, you know, I think Cole's been feeling a lot of pressure from that standpoint. So what do? You take him out of one of those RBI spots and put him into a place where he can be a little bit more successful and maybe a little bit more free and clear his head a little bit. And, you know, a lot of times that's moving a guy down in the order, right? Like you're taking pressure off a guy by putting him down at 7 in the lineup. Well, you're not doing that with Cole Messina. His profile is good enough to where he can go into the leadoff spot and be successful. And, you know, he's a guy who will steal a base for you. You know, he can do a lot well. So I think that that move certainly ended up paying off. It was certainly atypical, but if you think a little bit, dive a little bit below the surface, it makes a little bit of sense.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. I remember a long time ago talking with my good buddy Drew Meyer about this when he got to South Carolina and he was really scuffling. And Coach Tanner moved him up into the top of the lineup and he was like, Coach, I don't have a hit in my career here. Like he literally hadn't had a hit yet in a Gamecock uniform. Two different situations. I get it, John. But I'm talking about the feel of a head coach and knowing when and where to move a guy to kind of get him going. Well, they move Drew to the top of the lineup. They come to Charleston to play the Citadel, and like the third pitch he sees, he hits it halfway up the light pole in right field. And from there, he was an All-American, was born. And you really hope that that kind of gets Cole going and that you can wrap it around to get back to him. And we saw some life from the end of the lineup this weekend. I know that Reeves, I think he had eight and then he hit six, but the guy that hits at the end is Will Tippett. And I'm not so sure anybody in this league was struggling worse than Will Tippett was. And he found some lightning in a bottle and able to get a couple of balls deep to right. One of them left the yard. I know he had high strikeout numbers once again this weekend, but still he had hits. It's got to be incredible for his confidence. I know you know him, you know, personally too, just from being around and talking to him, interviewing him and those things. That is a huge boost to a guy who's been your staple at shortstop.
Yeah, and, you know, he's not coming out of shortstop. He's not coming out of the lineup this year. So, you know, folks are going to have to just start pulling for him. It's certainly a big deal for his confidence to see the ball go through the hoop, so to speak, a few times. And he did put the ball in play, and he struck out against guys who strike out guys. Like, he wasn't striking out guys. He wasn't going out there and swinging through 88-mile-an-hour fastballs. Like, he was competitive against Caglione before going down on a changeup, I think it was, from him. But he was fouling off 98-mile-an-hour fastballs, you know, that first time through. I mean, he was more competitive this weekend. And I think part of it is you know, narrowing his focus and going at it just as a right-handed hitter instead of a switch hitter. You know, he swung and missed more from the left side than he does from the right side. So, you know, I think that's going to be helpful for him going forward. But, you know, Florida, is as much as their pitching staff has struggled, when you look at their overall numbers, they've been decent in SEC play. They've been mid-pack in the SEC in terms of pitching numbers, but, you know, they strike out some dudes I wasn't disappointed in strikeout numbers on the weekend. You know, Florida strikes out guys, and I thought South Carolina struck out at about the rate that they should.
Yeah. As far as the pitchers go pertaining to strikeouts, we'll start yesterday and work our way back. Early in that first inning, I had a feeling it was going to be maybe a little bit of rough waters for Matthew Becker, because he wasn't getting a low strike. He wasn't getting the ball low in the zone, John. And it's hard for him to be what he's capable of being if he's not getting that pitch. Did you see the same thing? Or that's what it looked like.
That's what it looked like. And it is more difficult for Matthew when he's not getting that low pitch. I mean, he's not a guy who can beat you with a high fastball. You know, he's a 88, 90 mile an hour, occasional 91 mile an hour fastball guy. But he's got to get that low strike for him to be most successful, and he just wasn't. So, you know, he had a couple of good pitches hit. He made a couple of bad pitches. You know, I mean, Matthew's been great all year. And as Kingston said after the game Sunday, like, Matthew has gotten hit sometimes over the course of his career and bounced back pretty well the next time out. So, you know, I think you continue with him in the starting rotation as your Sunday guy, and see how things go, you know, next weekend. He was really good against a really good offensive lineup, you know, against Texas A&M. And I think he can certainly do that again this coming weekend against Arkansas.
Yeah, I'm a fan of that. I'm a fan of having guys who've pitched a bunch in their college careers, if you can get them in there in the weekend rotation. Ty Good, same thing. I mean, you wouldn't call his start an elite start on Saturday, but it was a good start. I mean, I thought both these guys actually had good stuff, John. I mean, so if you've got Eli, and you know basically what you're going to get out of Eli every Friday, and then you go to a fifth-year guy, and then you go to a Becker's been here. Is that 3 years or 4 years? 3 years, right? Three. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you go from Eli to a fifth-year guy to a third-year guy. I mean, it gives you some maturity on the mound in this league, and you've seen them pitch enough to know when it's time to maybe make a change. I guess the key is filling their spot in the bullpen. So how do you think that will shake out?
Yeah, I mean, I like Ty better out of the bullpen, to be honest with you. Okay. But we'll see what kind of decision they make there. I mean, I don't think that he was necessarily bad, you know, in the start this past weekend. And, you know, maybe you do give him another shot. But, you know, I like him better as a best – as a – you know, three inning guy out of the bullpen. I mean, there's some question marks in the bullpen right now. You know, you've last few times out, Garrett Gainey's gotten barreled up a little bit. You know, Chris Veach, you know, he's been great the first time he's pitched on a weekend and not quite as good the second time around. You know, you've got some question marks right there in my mind. And you know, you're also weakening what your bullpen looked like earlier on by you know, putting Good and Becker in that starting rotation. So, you know, they're still trying to fit the pieces of the puzzle together a little bit. You know, that's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, you would much rather have your starting rotation set and know who your guys are and whatnot. But there's a lot of folks out there who are still trying to figure some things out. So, you know, Florida's had a weekend rotation that's been a little bit of a revolving door, except for Caglione on Sundays. So, you know, it's they're still trying to work it out and get the right guys in the right spots. And, you know, maybe they're getting a little bit closer, but they've tried, you know, several different combinations, and now they got to figure out what's best for innings 1 through 9 on 3 different days.
John Whittle with the Big Spur. Our coverage of Gamecock baseball proudly presented by Resto Pros of the Midlands, who also is the title sponsor for next Monday's golf tournament at Fort Jackson. More on that in a moment. How about Roman Kimball? He's throwing more strikes. Seems to equate on the mound.
Yeah. I mean, Roman's looked better. He's looked good over 2 or 3 innings. Maybe not so much into that fourth, late in the third and fourth. But I wouldn't mind seeing him getting another crack in the rotation at some point. I think at the end of the day, you know, he's probably a good option as one of your starting pitchers. So I guess we'll see how that plays out. But it's been really encouraging his last few performances. So we'll see where they end up going from here. But he is throwing more strikes. He's working ahead a little bit more. That's been a big issue for him, obviously, here when he was struggling.
On a broader scale here, John, 11 teams in the SEC. I apologize for my camera. I'll get it fixed here in just a second. You can hear me okay, right?
Oh, yeah.
11 teams in the SEC. 11 teams in the SEC. Let me say this for a third time. 11 have ERAs, team-wide ERAs, well over 5. In league play, well over 5. That is wild. What is that telling you?
Well, it tells me that we're in an offensive era of baseball. You know, you've got umpires who are calling really tight zones and making pitchers go right at you, go right in there and put the ball, you know, right over the heart of the plate if they're wanting strikes called. And that's a big deal. But, you know, while pitchers are having some of their best velocity and you're figuring out a lot more things as far as, you know, spin rates and so forth, like, and where guys can hit, and you have better scouting reports than you ever have on hitters, you know, having to throw the ball in the zone, like they're having to right now is making things a little bit easier in some ways from an offensive standpoint. So, and you have so much video and scouting reports on pitchers now too, that you've got a great feel before you step into the batter's box, you know, what you're going to be seeing. So, you know, it's a good time right now to be a hitter, it seems like, because there are very few, elite pitching squads really anywhere. We're going to have to, you know, maybe change a little bit of expectations on what ERA should look like and how pitchers should you know, be perceived from a numbers standpoint.
Yeah, I agree. I think the strike zone sucks. I'm just gonna be honest with you. I think it sucks. I'm so tired of it. I cannot figure out why college baseball has decided that they want to call more balls. Like, I can't figure that out. Does anybody have an answer to this? Because, I mean, we talked to Chad every week. We talk to Stewart every week. We've talked to Mark about this. I've talked to Monty about this. You've heard other coaches from all across the country, Dave Van Horn and everybody else, say the same thing. Like, why are we so anxious to call so many balls? I just don't understand.
Yeah. I mean, that's the answer is the strike zone is supposed to be the strike zone. And if you're calling pitches out of the strike zone as an umpire, you're not going to be graded highly. And if you're not graded highly, you're not going to be getting the priority assignments and the postseason assignments. So,
yep.
I mean, that's why the zone is what it is. Now, I don't know what the answer is in terms of fixing it. I mean, I'd like for the strike zone to be the strike zone. I mean, if we go to robo umps or whatever it's called, I mean, that's going to call a tight zone too, unless you expand what the strike zone is supposed to be in terms of pitches off the plate or pitches up or down. If you expand it that way, I mean, I don't know what the right answer is in terms of fixing that problem.
I mean, I what was the problem before? I guess I'm confused as to what was so wrong before TrackMan got involved. Was baseball broken? Because I don't think it was.
No, I mean, I'm not saying that.
I'm not talking about you. I'm not talking about you. Yeah.
I mean, you get different umpires with different zones and fans and players and coaches and everybody clamor for consistency and that's hard to achieve with a moving strike zone. So then you start calling the strike zone, and it tightens. So, you know, there's not a little bit of grace when you get, you know, a half a ball or a ball off the plate. You know, you're not getting that call anymore. And, you know, that's just part of what happens, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, well, and when you do get that call now, it's magnified because right. They call everything so tightly, John. And when a pitcher gets a pitcher's pitch, Cole Messina does a great job, you know, framing up a ball that's basically, you know, threaded the needle. Essentially, what I'm getting at is when I say painting the black, like you're probably getting a half inch to an inch off the plate from, say, a guy like Matthew Becker who needs the low strike call. It, all of a sudden, everybody complains about it. That's been a strike for 100 years. And right. All of a sudden, a computer tells me it's not. Like, I think they need to throw this crap out. Part of the game of baseball is identifying and establishing the strike zone that is established by the umpire. Like, the umpire establishes a zone. You pitch to that zone. Some days it might give you an inch or two. Some days it might not give you much. I don't know. But I don't know. Like, I don't like robots. I think it's ridiculous. I don't ever want to see the game go to that. But I'm not so sure why we need to treat umpires like robots either. I just think it's bad for the game.
Well, and, you know, Ethan Petry struck out looking on a pitch in a big situation yesterday on a pitch that was, you know, probably is a ball. And, you know, that would be a call that and it was called a strike. That would be a strike under, you know, most for in the olden days before this TrackMan in tight mm-hmm. zone. But, you know, he took it because it was out of the zone and it was really close, but it should have been ball four and he should have walked and that rally should have kept going. But, you know, it's I don't know. It's just a different game than what it was.
I think we talked to Grayson last week. Grayson had a really good idea. He said, you know, if you're going to keep doing this, do what they've done in pro ball. I think it's two or three. You get two or three challenges a game. If you win it, you get to keep it. So on that particular pitch, Petry could have pointed to the dugout. King points upstairs. They look at it. That's a ball. Okay, that's ball four. If it's a strike, it's a strike. He's out of there. They've lost their challenge. Maybe that's something. And pitchers can do the same thing. They call, like, there were two pitches in the first inning yesterday that were strikes that Becker threw. They were strikes. And they were called balls. I mean, how much could that have changed? Maybe it could have even changed the umpire if they review it and they go, oh, that's actually a strike according to TrackMan. Okay, well, maybe I need to start giving that strike. I mean, how much that would help Matthew Becker? I don't know, man. I don't know. I think it sucks, to be honest with you. And I'm not just talking about from a South Carolina. I mean, I watch probably 10 college baseball games a week, if not more than that. It's happening everywhere. And it's just embarrassing. So I don't know. All right. Well, we'll move on from that. Sorry to get all hot and bothered, but umpiring has gotten under my skin, John. as you can probably tell. You got the Citadel coming up.
It is asinine, though, and it will drive you insane. I mean, it really does. And I'm glad you brought the Petry situation up, John, because I was thinking the exact same thing. I was like, you just – because it was back-to-back pitches basically in the same spot, if I recall correctly, one being a ball and the other being called a strike. And he wasn't the only one to have that misfortune fall upon them. yesterday. I mean, and it's just, I don't know. It used to be able to grade people on their consistency. That was what made an umpire an umpire. His zone was his zone, and so long as he called it the same for both teams, we're all good. But now it's just ridiculous.
I just don't know what.
You're going to have to get rid of the grading system to make it better,
or at least adjust it. Yeah. I mean, like, what was wrong with the game? Nobody can answer the question.
Right.
Well, I tell you what was wrong with the game 12, 13 years ago, John, you were covering it. Remember when they deadened the bats and you'd hit a ball that should go 420 feet and it was going 350? Like, that was screwing the game up. I don't know where umpire, I mean, yeah, if you've got a guy who's just consistently missing calls because he is like that inconsistent, you know what I mean? Like a guy, this zone here, this inning, the next inning, it's up here. If you've got a guy who's consistently giving 2-3 inches off the plate, I don't care about that. So what? So I don't know. Citadel tomorrow night, John. That's the only quad four game left for South Carolina. Dogs have had, oh gosh. I mean, I just feel for them. They've had backup position players all over the place filling in. So really important, but it would be good for the Lowcountry Gamecocks to be able to get out, watch their team play, and then Arkansas coming this weekend. You've already mentioned Arkansas staff is elite. It's the best pitching staff in the country. So they're going to have their hands full next weekend.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, big game tomorrow night. You know, South Carolina is going to have to find a new midweek starter this week. I'm not sure who they're going to go with. It feels like a Parker Marlott game to me. To start it out, but you know, it's going to be certainly a bullpen day with a bunch of different guys throwing an inning or two out there. So, you know, Eddie Copper is obviously done for the year, and you know, we'll see how these last three midweeks are approached, but you know, got to keep as many arms as you can ready to go this weekend for the Razorbacks and, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday series, which is good. So not playing on a quick turnaround or anything like that. And, you know, South Carolina should be ready to rock this weekend against one of the best pitching staffs in the country. And, you know, Arkansas is okay from an offensive standpoint, but, you know, they haven't been, you know, necessarily an elite offensive team, you know, especially in SEC games. They're kind of down towards the bottom of the pack in a lot, but in SEC games, they're the only team that has better than a 3 ERA. So that tells you a lot about who they are and what they do well.
Absolutely. Arkansas, the 2.96 ERA in league play, but just 2.38 at the plate in league play as well to offset it, as you just pointed out. Also, I want to give a big hat tip to Gamecock baseball from this standpoint. They are second in the league in fielding percentage in league play. They've only committed 9 errors. That's just one shy of Kentucky and Mississippi State, who have committed only 8 errors in SEC play this season. So the defense, well, there's a couple of plays. They had some quirky ones yesterday. That ball off the bat of Caglione that kind of squirted away up there third. You know, they had some strange stuff happen. But overall, they've been pretty clean out there. Yeah.
And I'll say this, that ball off of Caglione's bat, you know, I've been maybe a little bit too hard, or maybe not. I've been a little bit hard on Talmadge LaCroix for some defensive plays this year. There was Scott Rowland's not making that play off.
No.
Of that. I had the TV stream up there as well. So I was hoping that they would show a replay that could show that. And I didn't see them show a replay that showed just how hard it bounced, but I was up the first baseline a little bit. So I was looking straight down the pipe, and, you know, Talmadge had to come this way a little bit to cut the ball off. And then the ball just darted 4 to 5 feet to the right when it hit the grass. Like there was nobody making that play except for maybe Inspector Gadget. That was way too difficult or way too odd. So anyway, go ahead.
No, you're exactly right. It was very strange the way that it kind of did what it did. But overall, defensively, they've actually been pretty good. So hopefully that continues this week. They are, by the way, now number 20 in the D1 baseball poll. John, quick update. You had some news over the weekend pertaining to basketball. It was a little earth-shattering for those that follow recruiting for Lamont Paris's team. And then give us a plug for the Big Spur Golf Tournament, which is now less than 1 week away.
Well, you know, there was some news reported over the weekend Jamie Shaw on three put out there that, you know, Cam Scott's out of his NLI from Texas. And he doesn't quite have his full release yet. That maybe that comes today. But I would just urge a little bit of patience, not a ton of patience, just a little bit of patience on that situation right now. You know, if Cam, you know, does get his full release, then I anticipate South Carolina being involved, you know, with where things are right now in terms of, you know, timing on everything. Like, I don't anticipate this being a particularly lengthy recruiting process for Cam. You know, assuming he does get that full release, and which may come at some point today. So, you know, we'll see how that plays out, but I don't think you're going to have to wait a whole heck of a long time for news on how that situation is going to play out. A little bit of patience, not a ton of patience, but a little bit of patience, is what I would say with the Cam Scott situation.
And then patience off the tee next Monday morning.
Yeah, Monday, 9 o'clock. You know, Big Spur Golf Tournament out at Fort Jackson. We have a handful, six, you know, groups left, spots left for that many groups. Going to be a great time out there. $100 per player. Chris Payne from Nana's Porch is catering. He's going to be out there Sunday. He's going to get out there Sunday and start smoking a pig. Going to have barbecue and all the fixings out there. We're going to have a raffle and silent auction. The folks from Vista Art are going to be out there with their prints and so forth. They have a new women's basketball championship print that'll be on sale. We have some great raffle items. Tailgating from Nana's Porch for a group of eight for football season will be a highlight. Autographed game-worn glove from Whit Merrifield, G.G. Jackson rookie card that's autographed. We've got a round at Bulls Bay golf course out there that we'll have up. There's a ton of great stuff. It's a charity golf tournament. We're not putting money into my pocket or JC's pocket. This is a charity golf tournament for, it's going to support a couple of different organizations. One being Original Design, which, Jay Urich started, former South Carolina quarterback and wide receiver. And another is a on campus student athlete run charity called Dream on Three. So it is certainly going to be a great day out there at the course. 9 o'clock shotgun start. If you want to just come to lunch, you know, you can just come for lunch, but you can go to thebigspur.com. There's a message pinned right at the top. I'm going to tweet something out here in just a few minutes with a link to sign up. And, you know, please come out and do it. And you mentioned Resto Pros, Jeff Sturgis and his group. They're incredible. They're the title sponsor of this. And, you know, huge thanks to Jeff and his team over there. They do a wonderful job with their work and are great supporters of I know this show, but also you know, what we're doing. So really appreciate him and being the title sponsor, Jeff Sturgis, Vesto Pros of the Midlands.
And proud supporters of Gamecock Baseball as well. I can't thank them enough, as you pointed out, John. The music is on. We got to go. But great stuff as always. Hey, dude, I guess you're coming here tomorrow night, but after that, guess what? You're in town for a couple weeks. You don't have to go anywhere.
Well, headed from Charleston down to Jacksonville for a couple of days. Go see Jonah Bride play a little ball down for the Jumbo Shrimp. And then, which I might have to come back with a Jumbo Shrimp hat. You know, I got the Scott Sports hat on today, so maybe I'll come back next week with a Jacksonville
Shrimp hat. It's one of the
great. If they have a Jumbo Shrimp visor, please pick me one up and I'll pay you back.
I can get that done for you.
I'll see you this week, dude. So, yeah, please.
Look forward to seeing you. Don't
cut my big head. So, visors. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I look forward to seeing you next weekend. It's my kids on Sunday. We're taking the kids to the spring game, but their first Gamecock baseball game on Sunday. So, looking forward to trying to shield their eyes before they see the playground. When we come in.
Absolutely. Appreciate you guys having me. Y'all have a great week, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you, John. Great stuff. The bigspur.com. John is the best of the best. That's where you can sign up to play in next week's golf tournament. All right. It is noon. Mike Morgan up next here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
The season rolls on at Love Chevy, where the inventory is overflowing and the deals are in full bloom. Rev up your season with Love's exclusive specials on Suburbans, Tahoes, Silverados, Trailblazers, and the ever-popular Chevy Trax. They're hard to find. At Love Chevy, get behind the wheel and feel the possibilities. New adventures, new destinations, just you and the open road. Act now for Springtacular Savings at Love Chevrolet, the best selection of new Chevys, the lowest price, guaranteed. The other dealers upsell, overcharge, and will say most anything to get the sale. At Love Chevy, satisfied customers say it all. Things like helpful, knowledgeable, honest, and fun. Your trusted hometown Chevy dealer since 1961. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
That's the power of love. Love Chevy.
Hey, Gamecock fans. This is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
Hey, Gamecock Nation. My name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever, and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to McKellarEnterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks!
The National Anthem at Noon is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com. Incredible catering. Incredible. So anytime you need a caterer, that's where you want to go. BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com. Reference our name, of course. It'll take great care of you. CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com to have it delivered to your doorstep. By the way, if you live in the low country, and soon it'll be in all the food lines, but if you actually live in the low country, I know in Colombia, a lot easier, or if you don't want to go to the website and just have it delivered, Burbage Meats in West Ashley, they carry it. So you can always stop in there and pick up a bottle or two or six or whatever you need. Mike Morgan joins us for Power Hour, presented by our friend Ryan Brewer. Ryan Brewer Fence is where you'll want to go if you need one, business, home, whatever it is. They do a ton of work for the University of South Carolina, and there's a reason for that, because they're the best. He's the best, too. How was your weekend there, Mike?
It was great, guys. Great to be back with you. I always feel withdrawal symptoms when we go more than a couple of days without appearances, so it's good to be back in the comfortable space that is ITG, part of the burgeoning Chief Sports Network, and weekend was great. I got a little golf in myself, and actually had one of the better rounds I've had in a while. I played with my old high school basketball coach, who never stops coaching, and it's funny because when I'm around him, I revert to feel like I'm back like a 16, 17 year old, just hanging on every word and afraid to screw up. But he plays these mental games. He's really good. I mean, this is a guy that when he was getting started and coaching at various spots, he used to go to Hank Iba's house like every weekend in the off season. Former Olympic coach and legendary Oklahoma State coach. He learned from some really good people, and we were running he knows Tex Winter. We were running the triangle offense before the Chicago Bulls were. It's just bizarre. It's surreal to play with him. He looks like Martin Sheen, and he's in his late 60s, and the guy is just still like getting it done. Makes us all feel like, okay, are we going to be in that good a mental condition and shape when we get that age? But yeah, got to do some of that. Got to obviously watch some Masters, watch some baseball. Hate it for Spencer Strider. I know we got a lot of Braves fans out there. That is a major, major blow. It's not, they're going to make a move, maybe a couple. Anthopoulos is as good as they get, but you're not going to replace Spencer Strider. People don't give up pitchers that good unless it's a complete fire sale. So that's a major death blow. You could still win a seventh straight divisional title. And if you don't have Spencer Strider, who's the one guy that showed up on the mound for the Braves last postseason, I think that's crippling. But and then follow some of the spring football games, and I use that term loosely. It's really
what are we doing?
We are, as someone who's broadcasted a lot of these, we're now mailing it in. Let's be honest, we're mailing it in.
I agree with that.
We no longer, like, if I'm JC in the Big Spur, I'm probably getting more out of this past weekend's scrimmage than I will on Saturday for the spring game, where, I don't know, Dawn Staley will catch a touchdown pass, and maybe Hootie and the Blowfish will go out there on special teams and kick an extra point. Like, it's just become kind of a silly exhibition for most schools. I had LSU last year, and I will say this, the old school coaches like Brian Kelly, like, they were actually blitzing and hitting. There's a few left, but for the most part, they just realize, look, this is what it is. We're doing it because we have to do it. We don't want to do it. We're paranoid about having an injury, and everybody's second guessing us if that happens. So it now has become like the Pro Bowl, and more coaches are treating it as such. So I don't get a whole lot out of watching spring football games. I don't feel like I learn much at all about any of the teams.
Well, you don't have to hold a spring game. So
no, you don't, but the fans want it. I mean, you have some spring games that'll get over 50,000 people, whether or not you want to charge for tickets, and TV wants it because it's a 2-hour window. And I can tell you, like, the ones that I've done, they replay those suckers 100 times in the summer.
I know. Nobody,
you know, like, my phone will start blowing up like, yeah, I'm watching you on the LSU spring game. It's July 23rd at like 11 o'clock at night. I'm like, that game is 3 months old. Yeah. I just saw Jaden Daniels throw a nice post pattern, little skinny post there for the touchdown. Nice work there. 2 years ago, I had the Kentucky game in the snow. It snowed before the kickoff in the spring game. And we're all just like, what are we doing here? You know, Mark Stoops is saying, my God, do we really have to go through with this? So, yeah, I mean, there was a time where spring games actually did mean something. They weren't everything, but they were something. Now I'm convinced more than ever they're nothing. And if you really want to learn about players' progress, you're probably gain more from the scrimmages than you. And then, of course, a lot of coaches don't give you access to those. But I think you gain a lot more from that than you do a quote unquote spring game.
What do you think, JC? What if you closed it? And look, I get it, fans. It's not like fans are going to show up in the fall. It's not like you're hurting the fans. You're not. What if you closed it and just did one final scrimmage? Or, you know, what if college football made some adjustments and the Gamecocks played, you know, Presbyterian on Saturday and Clemson played Newberry, things like that?
Because inevitably, during a spring deal where you're emptying your bench and playing your walk-ons and Newberry keeps its starters, and you're going to lose a spring football game to Newberry, and somebody's going to get fired. I mean, think about someplace like Auburn. Auburn plays Samford in the spring game. All of a sudden, you know, through no fault of his own, Malzahn with a 21-7 ho-hum kind of lead, Samford kids are playing their ass off. He does the right thing, starts emptying his bench, plays his walk-ons, doesn't want to get anybody hurt. Samford comes back, picks up a fumble, returns it for a touchdown late, goes for two, and wins the game. Do you not think Yellowwood is going to call and fire him? Yes, War Eagle, you don't lose a spring game here. And I think that more so than injury is what coaches are worried about because, I mean, you know, look, I'll bring it back home when Gamecock fans were frustrated with Frank Martin a few years ago because he lost a exhibition to Augusta College in basketball. and it's like, that game doesn't count, guys. Well, it shouldn't have done it, you know. And so that's probably why if you're a coach, you're like, thanks, but no thanks. Now, could you – and we talked to Lugan Bill. We had him on. By the way, please go check out that interview. He'd be on fire.
Killer.
JC and Morgan. We got a lot of clips up of him too. He's really becoming a Swami of our time for the sport. a spokesman for the sport that uses common sense, like a whole lot of common sense. You got to love that about him. Anyway, I digress. You know, they got the UFL now and it's working. It's a better brand of football than maybe any other league outside of the NFL since the USFL back in the 80s. You know, it's good. So spring football is going to probably start becoming more of a thing where people are following teams and stuff. I wouldn't have a problem with some of these bowls moving to the spring and you go through spring practice, you get ready and you go play a bowl and, you know, maybe it counts on your record. Sure. You're still going to get people fired, but if you know going in, it's a game that counts, you know, or use it for a tiebreaker or something. I don't know, but then that's one thing, you know, and that's tricky too with all the roster churn and stuff that we go through these days as well. But it's just unlike high school where, you know, nobody cares if you lose the scrimmage or you lose the jamboree or whatever, because, you know, they've done it. The fans are used to it for, you know, 50 years, or in the pros where nobody cares about the preseason record. College fans are thirsty for, they're like a bunch of thirsty individuals. They're thirsty for everything they can get. I think a lot of them, yeah, myself included, they want to know the outcome of every game, you know, which I don't know why, because it takes all the fun out of it. And so you're constantly trying to predict. That's why people predict the records and stuff like that. So you start losing exhibitions. That's not good. I mean, that's a black mark, you know, no matter what the reality of the situation, no matter who's on the field. You know, you start losing the smaller teams. That's one thing. And then if say you go play another Power Five team, say South Carolina plays Georgia Tech. That's their kind of spring game, right? Would you really want to play a spring game against Paul Johnson's Georgia Tech? No. Jeff Collins? Heck yeah. Even Brent. Yeah. Right now they're traditional, but you know, you're not going to want to go and get your knees chopped off all day unless you got like a season opener against the Citadel or something, you know? So it's tricky as far as like, who are you going to play? And then how much is the outcome going to be weighed? I mean, I think, would it be positive? Yes. I think, would it help coaches coach better and prepare their team better? Yeah. Cause it gives you a look against an opponent, and that's invaluable. It's the only sport that you don't do that in. But I just think the fans and the pressure and the quick triggers on firing and the money, all the things that make college sports what they are, college football what it is, would work against that being a productive outing for your football program.
I don't know. I mean, I don't.
I don't think it's going to happen regardless. So, I mean, honestly.
You don't think what's going to happen?
We're ever going to see spring football matchups. I would love to see it.
But probably not.
I don't think we're anywhere close to that happening. I don't think the bowl schedule is going to be moved. I think that 10 years from now, we're going to be complaining about spring football, and it's going to be the exact same.
Bro, it's probably not a very out there take. Mike, I don't know. I mean, I guess if there are major changes that happen at some point in time, because you never know when it's going to pop up of we're, you know, college football separating and doing this, that, and the other. Those are things that certainly could come into the equation. The way that it is now, I don't see that happening either. But yeah, I don't know. I like the spring game. This is me now. This isn't JC or Mike or Phil or any of you in the chat box. I used to like the spring game because I like to go watch football and get to know the new guys. And
yeah.
I remember probably the most influential spring game ever on my life was 05, Coach Spurrier's first year. It was, oh my God, mm-hmm. Steve Spurrier's here. We all went into the bleachers just because we wanted to actually see the fact that Steve Spurrier was really the head football coach of the South Carolina Gamecocks. You could not believe that. But now, spring games to me are an opportunity to take my kids and have something fun to do for them. And
it's
that's
like going
it.
To the fair. It's like
going has to nothing a, to do with football. Yeah.
Like going to a spring training game in baseball. Like, you don't care who wins. You're going to see a lot of backups. There's no intensity. But it's fun at the old ballpark, right? You know, get yourself some peanuts and Cracker Jacks and have a good time.
I get a little bit out of it, like individual talent, eyeball test wise, but then you kind of look at it, and if you base it completely on performance, like that's what games are based on, is performance in game, you're going to get burnt as an evaluator. Cause like last year, Elijah Davis looked really good. Anybody hear anything from Elijah Davis all season? John Colasardo, I think is his name. He's a walk-on linebacker from Chapman. For two straight spring games, dude, this guy's been all over the field. It's like Brian Urlacher, right? And I mentioned him the first year. Oh, this guy may get on the field. Now, honestly, a couple times last year where they emptied the bench and he got on the field, he was making plays then too. So maybe he's just a guy that needs to play more. I don't know, special teams or something. But, you know, you go through and these heroes in the spring game that the season gets there and you're like, well, I mean, Eddie Lewis was a guy I thought could help, and he did against Furman and then disappeared for a lot of reasons. But Craig, Elijah Caldwell was not here for the spring last year. I'm going to explain this for the final time. That was during underwear workouts in shorts and shirts with Spencer during the summer when Elijah looked good. When the pads came on, Elijah went to bottom of depth chart.
Yeah,
it's a different game. Elijah Caldwell was not hyped during the spring. Go ahead.
I'll add this too, and we got to go to break, but chew on this for a second. Like one of the other things that you could get out of the spring game in years past was because you had consistency in a roster, right? So you could see so and so in year two, and so in year three, and so in year four, and it was a It was actually a pretty neat little measuring stick for fans, but it was also a good measuring stick for the staff. And this is where I'll let y'all chew. Obviously, JC, you'll be able to add way more to this than probably any of us could. But this is such an evaluation period now for all these staffs. I mean, you have so many mid-year enrollees now that you never used to have. And then you have so many transfers. And this is your first time to get to know these guys. So the way that you're evaluating in the spring period via practice and then via scrimmage and then via the spring game is, I would predict, and this would be something to ask Shane. I think we'll get Shane on after spring's over. How is it different evaluating a football team in the portal era and the mid-year enrollee era versus what once was, where you pretty much knew the large majority of your guys, you know, year over year? It's different. So when they run out there on Saturday, right, these coaches are still getting to – they don't even know some of these guys. I mean, I guarantee you there's coaches everywhere who are like, what's his first name again? 31. Oh, John. Yeah, John. That's right. Where did he come from? Texas. Oh, okay. You know, like, it's not like the old days. So it's a totally different eval period. Anyway, so I don't know. Chew on that for a second. I know Mike's got a very lengthy drive around the SEC. They're all going to be lengthy. Texas and Oklahoma are now part of the league, so we've got a long ways to go.
I can shorten it now. Lengthy is not – I don't know if I want that to be the staple of the love Chevy drive around the SEC.
I meant hypothetically, you know,
in terms of mileage and coverage,
right? Yeah, I-20, and then you got to cut up. Yeah, yeah,
It's a vast. Any
states that have panhandles are lengthy, and they both have panhandles.
We get from like I-10 to I-60, right? Like that covers the SEC these days.
Yeah, it's an expanding footprint, much like ITG is, you know.
Next season, it will be a flight around the SEC presented by Wheels Up right
here. Yeah,
right. That's the show.
Yeah, yeah. Road trips are going to become a little bit longer, a little more pricey for those that have the means to do so.
Yeah, we'll hop on with Quinn Ewers and his new Wheels Up deal. So hang tight. More on this. We've got some hoops. Really want to get your thoughts on Mark Pope. And clearly, we're halfway through the SEC baseball year. It's a great time to eval what's going on.
Fire Mitch Barnhart. Sorry. And,
that's right. No, it's fire Ray Tanner. It's Ray's fault that they didn't get their top three or four picks,
which they didn't, which I told you they wouldn't. That's Kentucky basketball getting rejection letters.
Yeah. It's Coach Tanner's fault.
It usually is. Yeah.
That's right.
Usually is.
Ray Tanner cannot hire a Kentucky basketball coach. He must be bludgeoned and banished.
GamecockTraditions.com will make you look really good for big Gamecock weekend. Make sure you visit them while you're in town. GamecockTraditions.com, Gamecock Traditions in Lexington, and the Village at Sandhill. We'll be right back.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cole Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well. And they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasports.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer. Go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer, just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
It's now time to take a drive around the SEC.
Brought to you by Love Chevy. Act now for spectacular savings on the best selection of new Chevys. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
Oh.
Okay. All right. I guess we're going now, huh, boys?
Yeah.
I missed the memo on that.
Phil, I think I misled you.
We teased it, right? Heading into the break. That means
I know.
Maybe
I
start it when we come.
No. That's not on you. That's on me. I was meaning for later, but I misled that whole thing. He was teasing the tease, Phil.
The actual tease coming up right now.
Yes.
No, it's okay.
On the Love Chevy driver on the SEC, Kentucky sells out.
Known when I saw the wide-eyed stare at the screen from you in the when it came on, I'm like,
you know what?
Oh hell, we're not ready for this, are we?
Hey, we're pros, man. I've always got one in my back pocket.
I was like, I knew I could count on you.
Yeah,
But okay, yeah. I'll eat that one.
Phil, I said it. It's on me.
Committed to the whole time spent listening thing and just drug that out for another at least one more 20-minute break.
It's okay. That is on me. I should have clarified it probably at the top of the hour. So I'll take the blame on that.
All right. So do you want to go here?
Go for it.
All right.
I got the band fired up. We're ready. Let's go.
It's the Love Chevy.
He put gas in
around the SEC. Our man Ben Hoover over there in Harbison, home of the $1,000 low price guarantee, best selection, best staff, best everything. Let's face it. All right, let's go for another Emmy here. Let's win another sports Emmy with this. We've got, let's see, 4 major items that I want to hit in this. Let's start with the Masters. Congratulations to SEC alum Scotty Scheffler. Everybody know where Scotty went?
Texas.
That's right. So we now have to call them SEC alums. In fact, they won 3 Big 12 championships. He's originally from New Jersey. I was doing a deep dive on Mr. Scheffler since looks like he could be the next big thing in golf, because it seems like a lot of these other guys, they get their money, particularly if they get the Live Tour money. They moved to Jupiter, where JC had his wedding. That's like golf capital of the world. They all live in Jupiter, have their mansions, have their yachts, and a lot of them, like for example, a Brooks Koepka, who I know some people who went to high school with Brooks at Cardinal Newman in Lake Worth, they get their money, they get their girl, and the motivation is not there. I mean, that's what made Tiger Tiger. Tiger was sitting on, you know, $100 million. I was told a story that Tiger, before the British Open, the way he would prepare, he would wake up at like 1 a.m. every day to adjust to the time zone of Great Britain, right? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's the kind of dedication. I don't know if some of these guys have that, because I keep asking people that know a hell of a lot more about golf than I do. Why is it the next best thing doesn't stay good for more than a couple of years? Yeah. And we keep having this turnover, right? anyway, Scheffler was after 9/11, his family moved to Texas. He had a stay-at-home dad. His mom was working. This is not your typical dude either. Like, he's not just like an empty vessel that's really good at golf. He graduated with a bachelor's degree in finance. He's very religious. He's very family oriented. He told everybody if his wife went into labor, he was leaving the tournament. He's very grounded, it seems like. Part of the U.S. team that won 27 Walker Cup. There's a number of SEC alums that are on the PGA Tour, but Scottie Scheffler, he might be going on one of those runs because he just seems unflappable out there. He doesn't seem like the kind of guy who's going to take a bunch of millions of dollars, be like, yeah, okay, been there, done that. I'm not motivated anymore. Let's go party. As you mentioned, Jamie, Kentucky has its coach. He is Mark Pope. He was on the 96 title team. This is a fascinating, like, psychological case study. If you follow Big Blue Nation, remember, Mark Pope was not only not the first choice. They went after Nate Oates, got a no. Went after Chris Beard, got a no. Went after Hurley, got a no. And you won't convince me that they didn't at least feel out Billy Donovan. And he basically said, no, I'm staying in the NBA. I'm very happy right now with the Chicago Bulls. So insert Mark Pope. And there's a guy who hasn't won an NCAA tournament game. This is all how you phase this. On JC and Morgan years ago, we used to do this thing where I would be like spin doctor for a particular hire. And I can tell you why it was a good hire. And I can tell you why it was a bad hire. So let's do this exercise. We're Kentucky, man. We can't get a coach more established than Mark, but we can get anybody who we want. This guy hasn't even won an NCAA tournament game. He's not that young. He's not like Billy Donovan at 30. What are we doing here? Were we just desperate? This is the best we could come up with? Fast forward, they go to Rupp Arena. They sell out the press conference, 20,000 fans. A bus rolls out there. The 96 title team walks. There's Tony Delk, and, you know, there's Shepard's pops, right? Jeff Shepard. Then all of a sudden you start hearing like, you know what? This guy's got something. He's one of us. And oh, by the way, he runs an exciting brand of offense that Rick Pitino likes. And he's going to be hungry, unlike Calipari, who clearly lost his hunger. I can spin it either way. The fact of the matter is, I don't know if this is how it's going to work out. Did I have Mark Pope on my bingo card? No, not at all. But I give Mitch Barnhart credit. He went out there. He's going to be defined in a lot of ways on this hire, fairly or unfairly, and we'll see how he does. See how it works out.
I like the hire. I think he's a basketball coach. They need a basketball coach. I mean, they're Kentucky. They're going to sign the best players. Can the guy coach basketball or not?
He took BYU to two titles in the after the two titles. Sorry, that's a big one. He took BYU to two tournaments, NCAA tournaments, and the second one was when everybody said, "Well, yeah, they're in the Big 12 now. Let's see what you got." And he still took them to the NCAA tournament. So the guy could coach. I'll tell you, truth be told, I had him on my radar when the South Carolina job came open. He was a guy I was looking at all kinds of names out there. And Mark Pope was somebody that I had my eye on. Now, did I think he was going to land Moby Dick, which is Kentucky basketball? No, I didn't think that. But good for him, man. Good for him. You know, the alumni, good vibes that only last so far. You still got to win. And they need to get to a Sweet 16 in like year one to satisfy that fan base.
Hey, by the way, if you real quick, Mike, if you go to Wikipedia, and yeah, type in Mark Pope.
Right.
So, somebody has updated the Mark Pope resume at BYU. His five seasons as coach there, 2019 through 2024. And in those 5 years, he went 24-0, 25-0, 26-0, 19-0, 26. He's 121-0.
How about that? Wikipedia is a fascinating. First of all, whenever you go there, they're begging you for money, right? Like, I can't go to Wikipedia without them going, "Hey, could you spare $5?" And secondly, it really is a great source for information. but you also have to double check like everything, because right. that stuff happens all the time.
Guy never lost a game.
Priceless, right? What do you think of Eli Jones, Jamie?
I'm a huge fan, both personally and professionally. Outstanding.
Old school kind of ground ball, sinker ball pitcher.
Yeah, love it. Got to have it in this league, yeah.
Well, if you don't have complete just electric swing and miss stuff, 67% of his ground ball is coming off the two-seamer, so he's kind of a throwback, right? I mean, the SEC is full of these guys that light up radar guns and plus-plus velocity, and they're all projected first-rounders, and he's kind of a I'm not going to say he's Kip Balknight, but like he's just a different kind of guy. I appreciate that. I think the game of baseball is going to become really boring if everybody out there just throws smoke and everybody who's at the plate is swinging for the fences. That ain't great. I like that. I like to see more of that. Hey, have you guys been keeping up with Kentucky baseball? I mean, this is ridiculous. 14-1.
Yeah.
14-1. They just swept Auburn. Look, they're another one. Nick Mangione, they've adapted to their ballpark, which you don't have a ton of home runs there. They'll bunt, they'll hit and run, they'll a lot of motion on the bases, a lot of the little things. They almost at times play like a West Coast team, but they also have some pop. You know, they also have some power, but they're a refreshing story. Do they keep it up? I don't know. Kentucky is the one team in the SEC, the one program out of 16 now. It's never been to Omaha. So they're off to a great start. We're at the midway point, the turn, if you will. Tennessee finally heating up. They sweep LSU. They're 1-5, strong as anybody. Blake Burke leading the way, 25-game hitting streak, leading the league and hitting an SEC play. And then there's LSU. The defending national champions have lost 5 consecutive series in the SEC, the first time since 1992. Wow.
Yeah.
We talked about this last week. Nobody is immune to the down year in SEC baseball. Nobody. And when you lose some big-time players, I mean, Ray knew after that third trip to the national championship finals, you're going to lose the nucleus of that whole unit. Like there was, I don't care who took over that job. I don't care if Ray stayed. There was going to be a drop-off. There just was. And it wasn't a significant drop-off. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, they still went to a super in year one at Chad, right?
Yeah. Should have won it. Yeah, they got beat by North Carolina. It was a super lasted for like 8 days because Whittle was in Chapel Hill for forever and ran out of clothes because they had so many rain delays. Carolina should have won it. I mean, but then the next year, you know, Maryland, they were again a regional. Maryland beat them. And then the next year, the bottom fell out. They didn't make anything. And that was the first non-NCAA season since 99 in 2015.
I picture Whittle like in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles where John Candy, he's living out of a suitcase and he puts his underwear in the sink to wash them and Steve Martin walks in and grabs him up. He's like, what the hell is this? Hey, Neil Page, don't mind my drawers. They're in the sink.
Clint, I gotta mention this. Reese was 07, not 13. Go ahead.
Reese was 07. Yeah, the three errors. I remember that well. You know what else I remember that about that? There was a guy who was calling, I'm not going to mention his name, Tar Heel Baseball. So that me, TP, and I believe I got Tommy Moody to drive and join us. And they were doing some construction at the Bosch, so we didn't have our own booth. We had a little wooden partition separating us and the Tar Heel radio crew. And the guy who does Tar Heels, he's one of those guys, he's a loud talker. So he doesn't realize the microphone can mod, you know, like you don't have to yell and scream every word. But he is everything. We're back here on the Tar Heel Sports Network, and let me just say, and it's going like that, and I'm getting calls and text messages from Gamecock fans going, would you tell that A clown to shut the hell up or at least lower his voice? It's bleeding over into the broadcast. And I've never done that, but I politely walked over there and I just said, hey, buddy, you know, it's just a partition here. Everything you say is going over on our Gamecock broadcast. You might want to just, you know, you're at a 10. Maybe go to an 8.
Hey, buddy.
And he just kind of looked at me like, hey, man, that's how I do. I just yell and scream the whole time. And I'm a wild talker.
That's how we roll.
That's how I roll, baby. That's how we roll. My thing.
The Bucky Games.
Okay.
That's my thing.
I would have been like,
don't
all right.
Tell me, don't tell me how to do me. So I told Tommy.
I'd have been sitting there banging on that partition and trying to like bother him. I'd have been like, boom, 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 boom. Every time he got loud, I'd be like, knock, 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 knock.
I mean, that's like some high school radio crap, you know? I mean, that's what you hear. The local radio guy goes to the, you know, the local high school that's big enough to support having some radio listeners. It's like, that's like listening to the damn Burns games in high school football season.
Yo,
with that guy. Hey, that's exactly what
that
sounds like.
Don't hate on the Burns games.
I'm hating on the cheddar head they got announced.
It used to be nothing but
scream into the microphone.
Greg McKinney was good at it.
There were none better than Greg. No.
I was a sideline reporter for Burns football for 1 year. Of course, it's my alma mater, and I'd just gotten back to town. And my buddy was the coach. Like, my quarterback from high school, Brian, was the coach. He's since gone on and won a state championship at Westside. It was the worst Burns high school football season since I was in ninth grade. They went 3-8. They lost to everybody. And I had to interview my buddy after the game as the sideline reporter. I just got so uncomfortable and awkward. I said, I'll never do sideline reporting again, ever. Anyway, that's a little story
there. That's America's loss. That's all I can say about that. we can see if we can get that. Hell, they've had about 27 different Gamecock football sideline guys in the last 20 years. So I'm sure they'll take applications. One other baseball note. So Charlie Condon, I realize we don't talk a lot of Georgia baseball here. Georgia baseball has been a woeful underachiever for years and years and years. I do think Wes Johnson was a good hire, and he'll do good things eventually. But they haven't sniffed Omaha in forever, it feels like. They fired Dave Perno, who took them there 3 times. So Charlie Condon, who's leading the planet in like everything,
mm-hmm.
Did you realize he was a preferred walk-on at the University of Georgia?
Yeah.
He did not play at all as a freshman. He redshirted. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so he was just completely overlooked in the recruiting process. The big kid, this is what he's doing. This past weekend, he hit his 24th home run.
Mm-hmm.
His batting average is .482. His slugging, whenever you have a decimal and a number to the left of the decimal in slugging, that's insanely good. That's RBI baseball, to use an old Nintendo reference, good. 1.109 is his slug. His OPS, which to me is, if you really want a number that tells you how good a hitter is doing, I know this is not digestible to the masses yet. Is a good OPS, even in college baseball, what would you say, Jamie? Like 850 would be a really good OPS.
Yeah.
I mean, 900, you're ripping it. His OPS, 1.695.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Which, by the way, folks were wondering, is on base plus slugging.
On base plus slugging, OPS. It's insane. Become a very in vogue number over the last 10 years, but I think it's a very telling one. I'm not a big war guy. I think war is full of crap, but I think OPS is actually very legit. So when have we seen this kind of dominance? Because, I mean, if you project his numbers, he is going to break all kinds of records. Chris Bryant comes to mind. In 2013, Bryant hit 31 home runs. Remember, that was kind of the dead ball era. They deadened the bats. They hadn't fixed the baseball yet. So he was out homering teams back in 2013. 31. I remember broadcast games for ESPN where you didn't have a single ball hit the warning track. It was terrible baseball. And then you had Gorilla Ball back in the days of Pete Incaviglia. Anybody remember that name, Pete Incaviglia?
Well, yeah, Pete hit 100 home runs in his career. He's the only player in the history of the game to do it in college baseball.
And he had a single season record of 48, but back then there was no limit on how many you played. So he's at Oklahoma State. They played in 75 games.
Yeah.
Right? And 65 regular season games.
Right. He only played 3 years.
Right. Yeah. First round draft pick of the Rangers. So the 21st century college hitter record last year was Jack Caglione of Florida with 33. I mean, we got Condon sitting at 24 right now. I think he's going to shatter the record. And again, it's Georgia, so nobody is talking about it nationally. But I appreciate greatness. He is freaking great. Yeah. What he is doing right now is unreal. All right. I mentioned this briefly. Spring football has kind of taken a dip. Did you guys see what Ole Miss did on Saturday?
Yeah, I think I was most a fan of the Joey Chestnut sighting.
Yeah.
Didn't really care for the tire rolls or the dunk contest, but the hot dog thing, I can do the hot dog thing.
All right, I'm with you there. I like a good Joey Chestnut scarfing down a Nathan's dog or 100 of them as much as anybody. But putting a hardwood floor on the field to have a dunk contest, having a tug of war, playing with no pads, having 7-on-7, basically Lane Kiffin said, this is a joke, and I'm going to play it as such. The circus is in town, and this is what we're doing. That was the ultimate. It was like Midnight Madness meets the Pro Bowl, is essentially what it was in Oxford. And look, I'm not hating on it. I get it. Like, nobody's taking them seriously anymore. So that's what they did in Oxford, and we'll see what they do Saturday in Columbia. Maybe, let's see, maybe Dawn Staley will be in the wing tee, and then they'll run a reverse, and she'll hand it off to Justin Smoke, and then he'll throw a pass down the field to a streaking Darius Rucker, and then Darius will stop at the goal line, and then he'll give it to
this is getting fancy.
he'll give it to Josh Gray. And Josh Gray will then take it and do a dunk on the crossbar, and that'll be the most exciting touchdown that you'll see on Saturday. And that is your Love Chevy drive around the SEC.
Brought to you by Love Chevy, where the inventory is overflowing and the deals are in full bloom. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
Together, let's drive.
All right, I got something to say. So I just got a text from our boy Perry at Britain's.
And all right.
Remind everybody of this. On Saturday, so you guys know the mighty sound of the Southeast, the marching band got invited to the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade in New York City. Big honor for any marching band. I think it's the first time they've been able to go. Well, Perry's a big supporter of the Carolina Band, and they're having a fundraiser the day of the spring game from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. You got food, prizes. You win a $100 gift certificate. That'll get you a really, really nice shirt. Like, we don't have our Britons on today, but I have mine packed and ready to go. Comfortable shirt, slimming. Also, I'll say that they're very slimming shirts. And 10 to 6 day of the spring game, many of you will be in town anyway. Go swing by there on Divine Street right before the baseball game. Get you to take a look at their selections. And support the Gamecock Marching Band. Mighty Sound of the Southeast Britons does dress the show during the season as one of our sponsors. So wanted to give a nice shout out there to him. I told him I would do that many, many times before Saturday.
Oh, that sounds fantastic. All right. And that's at Britons?
Yeah, Britons of Columbia on Divine Street. So it's he'll be out there, and it's like I said, it goes to support the all the funds or whatever go to support the marching band going to New York City for the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade so they can play Step to the Rear but beside the inflatable Bart Simpson and Snoopy and all those, you know.
That stupid. Would be, yeah, fantastic.
I saw, what if somebody like, not a terrorist, but maybe kind of like the guy on that movie 12 Monkeys, Brad Pitt's role, like decided they were going to coordinated an attack and cut all the cords for those floats and set them
there's
free.
There's a reference. Is
that a fiber for you? Remember 12? Yeah. 12 Monkeys is up there.
I was a one and done for me. I saw it when I was, fairly young. I didn't really grasp a whole lot of that movie, to be honest with you. And then I hit it and quit it.
I don't want to spoil it, but it's... Well,
Sam Murphy at the opening bell of my segment here on the Power Hour says, Mike, finished the Sopranos over the weekend. Thoughts on how the finale ended? Then someone else said, don't spoil it. I still don't plan on watching it. So if I can't tell you how the Sopranos ended, you can't say how 12 Monkeys ended, JC. Spoiler alert.
Jan says, don't forget the Rosie O'Donnell balloon. Only Rosie O'Donnell. Rosie O'Donnell's a loser. And yeah, anyway, I don't know. She was great in the League of Their Own.
Yeah.
Maybe. I don't know.
They were all great.
Madonna very much either, but she was great in the League of Their Own.
She was great in the League of Their Own too.
Hell, I don't like Gina Davis very much. Patricia Arquette. Who was Arquette's little sister? I don't really like very many of them at all, but JC, I like that movie.
I thought of you the other day. So I got a new TV. It's a Samsung, and it's a smart TV. So Samsung has their own channels. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like different movie channels, different comedy channels. They have a sports station that just airs random games from years past. They had the one that Seth Greenberg and I called a year ago with G.G. Jackson going up against Brandon Miller, the overtime game in Columbia. I was like, this is actually on a channel right now. And then they have a channel, I blank you not, that all they do is for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, run Family Ties. Sha-na-na-na. 24/7. And
so the theme song's on a loop there.
Oh, it's a total pimp song.
It's a pimp song.
I'm like, every time they play it, I'm like, I'm jazzed to like watch another episode. And it brings me back to my childhood and all that other good stuff. But Gina Davis was one of the women that Alex P. Keaton dated. Courtney Cox was one of the women that Alex P. Keaton dated. He went through a flurry of hotties. Alex P. Keaton was crushing on Family Ties back in the 80s.
Yes, he was. Justine Bateman played his sister. It's Jason Bateman's sister. I always thought she was kind of hot, but
her career. Yeah, it's
so the wife and I started watching Married with Children, like for pilot on through. It's on Paramount or it's on Max, and because it's based in Chicago. Like I saw the fountain from the beginning of the show one day because we were downtown. It's like that fountain looks familiar. I'm getting deja vu like crazy. And she's like, is it from the opening of Married with Children? I'm like, yes, it is. There's that
love film. And marriage.
Al Bundy I've never was seen Paul, by the way. And
I have
life.
Never Paul Kai.
He played college ball. Like he was a legit athlete.
In the Mac or something like Ohio U or someplace.
Oh, and he's a hell of a coach too. And the little Giants put that old Moranis in his. You know, put him in his
there place. Yeah, there you go. Straight out, pig.
Blow the whistle.
But so we're sitting there watching, and it's one of those where he's like, he's giving his buddy advice, and his buddy's got his kid with him, and he's like, tell my kids some advice. You know, he's like, never get married, blah, 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 women, blah, blah, blah. And the kid is Joey from Friends. And I'm like, wow, that's just, it's kind of crazy when you look back on it. You know, the guy that played Jefferson Darcy in Married with Children was also on the freaking Love Boat.
Yeah.
Everybody was on the Love Boat. Yeah. There's a YouTube video of every celebrity that was on that show. It's insane.
He was also on Happy Days. Like he was the cousin on Happy Days. Jefferson Darcy from Married with Children. He's been on a ton of stuff.
Peg in Married with Children. It's hard to believe she ended up playing the role that she did in Sons of Anarchy.
Oh, complete. Yeah. Whoa. I mean, that now
she was incredible.
That's great act. That she's Katie Segal. She's good. Yeah.
She's incredible. Yeah. Incredible actress.
Jefferson was in Revenge of the Nerds too. He was the jock for Alpha.
Like,
oh, yes. That's Ted McGinley, right?
You think about all of them.
Yeah.
That makes me want to start watching Sons of Anarchy again. I just love that show. But like, how about like what Christina Applegate's going through right now, man? Like
it's sad. Yeah.
It is so sad. You know,
I just listened to a podcast she was on for like an hour. There's a podcast called, with Dana Carvey and David Spade.
It's good. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, it is really good. I've heard that. Yes.
It's really good. And they had her on for like an hour talking about everything she's been through and all that. It's very interesting, very sad in a way because she has MS and as she points out, like it just does not get any better. She's just trying to get through life with it. She just had that show Dead to Me, which my wife and I watched. It was actually pretty entertaining. And she was really good in that as well. But yeah, probably a good time for the bumper. We're going back.
Yeah, Christina Applegate was kind of on my Britney Spears list. Like, yeah, probably.
I love Christina Applegate.
I think
she
every
was
guy,
even like an Anchorman. Remember an Anchorman? She was just as hot.
Every
I thought she was hotter. I think.
Yeah.
Anchorman, yeah. Every role she's ever played has been phenomenal. Me and that Veronica Vaughn got it on.
That Veronica Vaughn. There's a Chris Farley mini series or movie one coming out. Chris Farley, like somebody's playing Chris Farley. It should be interesting.
Bruin, I'm with you. Gemma's role in Sons of Anarchy was just phenomenal. I mean,
I need to see that. I have not. Shame
you've
me,
never
please.
Seen Sons of Anarchy.
Yeah,
bring it.
Oh. I never have either. Yep. Nope.
Hey, we can put together a must see list of stuff, Jamie. And I'm going to tell you,
Mike,
you've got some homework.
That's fine, but this is the summer of SOA for you. Get it in before football, because you can't.
Okay.
You will. You and Summer, like, you won't go to... Has she seen Sons of Anarchy?
No. She doesn't, doesn't watch a lot of TV. She looks at me and how much
you
TV
won't go to bed.
Gonna watch?
Like, those... Yeah, you can't...
Where I didn't watch it because I didn't think I'd like it. There's a lot of shows I've never seen The Wire. Somebody in chat row mentioned The Wire. I'm sure I'd love The Wire, but I can only... Again, the buffet table, my plate, I can only put so much on there. And I mean, 24 hours of Family Ties, Sha-na-na-na. How am I gonna switch from that? Hey, Monday, kids eat free, Salsaritas, two locations. Get yourself a taco bar, Fiesta Bar, if you want to do a little catering. Lexington Target Center. You've also got the West Columbia installment as well. That is Suki and the gang at Salsaritas. Terrific. Tex Mex, a lot of our listeners have had the opportunity to win a Fiesta pack and have loved it. If you don't win a Fiesta pack, you can still enjoy Salsaritas, two locations in the Midlands.
When we return, Ethan Petrie, we mentioned home runs. He's climbing the charts, and if you're at Founders Park this weekend, you might see him do something that only 9 players in the history of the school have done.
JC, what was the positive meter on Big Spur for the Gamecocks winning a series on the road against a Florida team that had to have that series? What was the positive meter?
Was blew it on Sunday.
Game? Yeah, it was Monday. Killed it, I'm sure. Sunday.
I knew it. Nah, it's a little more positive this week about baseball. Football's really it's become the sorrow swamp that killed Atreyu and the horse and the rock man and the never ending story. It's become the nothing. These people are all sitting around slitting their wrists preparing for the nothing to come.
JC getting frustrated over text messages and posts about negative football. That's what I'm here for. He's like Mutombo swatting weak shots in the paint. He's rejecting them left and right, and I can't get enough of it.
Hey, it's not time. Well, I got depressed after 2-6 last year. I'll admit it. I knew it was coming. I didn't think they'd win all 4. I was depressed, but I got over it, man. I've gotten married since then. I've grown as a human.
You haven't been through a football season married yet. Well, the real test is coming. So let's see how you do.
Actually, I went through about 10 of them, and just a reason. Those didn't go too well for me.
Anyway, Nat, we're here for you, Nat. All right, we got to get a break, guys. We've got to hit a break. We're missing breaks here. So we'll hit a timeout. We'll be right back.
We have started in 1979. Because we're a manufacturer, we're able to control our costs. That's why we like to manufacture as much of the product as we can, because in our factory stores, we can offer a competitive edge over other people around the country. When people come into one of our Palm Casuals, it's like they're buying their car at Detroit. They're going right to the factory and buying their car.
30-day money-back guarantee. That's a big deal with us. I mean, we give 30 days to do anything. I mean, return it, change it, get a different color, get your money back.
When you pull into a store and it says Palm Casual, you know you're at a factory store.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. Rescuesandresin.com, and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Hey, Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington in the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online, or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium in the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arena. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
It's 2024, and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming on the Chief Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chief Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
This is Zachary Davis from Carolina Hoop.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Touchdown Brewer. Set up a screen and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown Brewer, his second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer. Turns the corner. Touchdown, number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer, Ryan Brewer Fence. The website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina, and we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man, the building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
It is the final hour. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston, electricbikescharleston.com. All week long, it'll be in the 80s. If you'd like to be in the 80s and cruising up to 28 miles per hour, electricbikescharleston.com is where you can go to find your next bike. They've got every brand. They've got the best service. They can prove that. The best warranties, they can prove that as well. And service is more than just being in the store. It's also being outside of the store. Down the road, if something happens, you can call Michelle and her team at Electric Bikes of Charleston. They're going to take care of it. And they serve people everywhere, not just in the Lowcountry, but all across the great state of South Carolina. Charleston Fitness Equipment is located within those same walls, and they've got everything as well. If it's getting pretty late, if you really wanted to tone up before the summer, you better get a move on it. But they've got everything you need in there to do that. Home gyms, free weights, whatever. Charleston Fitness Equipment, Electric Bikes for Charleston, proud supporters of the University of South Carolina, proud supporters of our program, and the Garnet Trust. A couple of quick notes here to lead off hour three. Congratulations to Clint Haggard, who has long been the athletic trainer at the University of South Carolina for their football program. Clint has been named the best in the country. The Intercollegiate Council for Sports Medicine has named him the National Head Athletic Trainer of the Year. So congratulations to a great dude, Clint Haggard, for what he does for South Carolina. And then if you missed it last night in Memphis, the final game of the year for the Grizzlies, who were awful, but G.G. Jackson sure wasn't. 17 of 36 from the floor in 44 minutes. They gave up 126 points as – it's kind of the norm in the NBA today. Defense is a thing of the past. They lost, but 12 boards, one assist, one block, 44 points for GG, 31 on Friday. So the final two games of his rookie campaign culminated in 75 points for GG Jackson. So hats off to him.
You could have an all South Carolina that is coming from the state of South Carolina backcourt when Ja Morant gets back next year.
Yeah. Yeah,
Ja and Gigi, you think that wouldn't be a fun backcourt to watch?
They'd probably score 75 points a game combined.
They'll be playing in more relevant games than last night. Not to take away anything from what Gigi did, but
no, you know, yeah.
Once teams have clinched or not clinched, there's a lot of teams that just sit. Luka didn't play totally his final game. He should win the MVP. Led the league in scoring, second in assists, but they just sat them. They just rest players. It's kind of like the final week of an NFL season when you've already clinched. So, yeah, to your point, There's not a lot of defense being played anyway. But then when you have that set up, there's like none. It's like everybody go out there, get your shots up, get your numbers. But no, he is he's going to be good for a long time in that league. I'm sorry it didn't work out better at South Carolina. I think it was a lot of immaturity, quite frankly. But he went back to see Lamont in practice. There's always going to be that bond there. There's always going to be that tie there. So 10 years from now, people won't remember that it didn't go great at South Carolina, but they'll remember he went there, and he'll always be a Gamecock, and he's got a chance to be something special at the NBA level.
There's no question. There's no question about that. Speaking of special, Mike, guys, it's still going to take some time, but not only can it happen, there's a real chance that this might happen. Ethan Petrie is well on his way to breaking the home run record that Justin Smoak set back in 2008 at South Carolina. And you don't ever want to count your eggs or chickens or before they hatch or whatever the phrase is. But here's the reality of it. After this weekend, he's hit 38 home runs, which ties him with Eric Stanton, another great former player who his final year in a Gamecock uniform was 1998. And whenever he hits his next two, he will become the 13th player ever to hit 40 home runs in a South Carolina uniform. We're just a little over halfway through his sophomore year. Justin, of course, has the all-time record at 62. And then behind Smoke, it takes a while to get there. Hank Small hit 48 back in the 70s. Garrett Carter in the 80s hit 47. Jeff Parnell hit 45 in the early 90s. He's followed by Landon, who hit 44 through 2004. Chris Boyle with 43. Disher hit 42. Pierce would have set the record. Pierce hit 42 in 2 years, 04 and 05. Darnell hit 41. Trip Kelly hit 41. And Charlie Aldrich hit 41 as well through his final year in 1987. And then there's Eric Stanton and now Ethan Petrie. And guys, he's going to start to pass. He's already begun to, of course. He's passed some outstanding names. He was tied with Derek Urquhart, Mike, who you've met, you know, Derek. And now he's passed Derek. He's already passed Ryan Bordenick. And next on the list is Charlie Aldrich, Trip Kelly, and James Darnell. I mean, this guy, you mentioned Charlie Condon earlier, and you're right. Charlie Condon and Jack Caglione are freaks. I mean, every single swing, you feel like the ball is about to leave the yard. That is incredibly rare. And this kid, he's not in that category yet, but he's getting pretty close. And next year, of course, he'll be a junior, and he'll be up there where Caglione is now and things of that nature. But it's really a neat thing to see here. This guy climbing the record books. Right? It's not like he's hitting 250. You know, he's a 320, 330 hitter. It's pretty remarkable.
You're muted, Mike. Mike.
You're muted, Mike.
I swear I didn't. I always feel obligated when we're talking. Really? Am I back down? Okay. I need to send Shore an email.
Yeah, what's going on there?
Yeah.
He just got muted again. Is it muting on its own?
Well, there's a button to mute it.
Yeah, Mike, you're muted. It. Mute your mic or is the screen muted? There you go. Oh, but we still can't.
Oh my gosh. Oh well. Ghost in the machine.
There is indeed.
I don't understand.
I don't either.
Test 1, 2. Check 1, 2.
Check.
Yeah, I'm confused as to what's going on. It looks like his mic is off, but he's unmuted on the screen, right, Phil?
That is correct.
Check, make sure you're plugged in.
Now he's muted on the screen.
Yeah, there's something that's triggering that on his end. I don't know what it is.
Are we back?
Yeah,
we are back.
That was weird.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I don't know. I apologize. I was just going to say, I feel obligated to say, when we're talking about the pantheon of great Gamecock sluggers, Steve Pierce had 42 home runs in 2 years. If he played a third, he'd own almost every Carolina record imaginable. Pierce and Smoke were the best two I ever saw. One of the most surreal moments was getting to call a Steve Pierce series in Pittsburgh when I was with the Braves, and going to the Pirates clubhouse and just catching up with him. And then he wound up winning MVP of a World Series with the Red Sox. I don't know if that'll ever be trumped. That's pretty damn impressive. But Pierce was as good a raw hitter as I've ever seen in a Carolina uniform. He's just absolutely, but he only played 2 years. Now, if you projected 3 years, he would have had 65 home runs, give or take. He was insanely talented. One other thing, Big Wash says, Mike, Gigi's not a backcourt player. He's an athletic big. You're not wrong, and you're not completely right. It's positionless basketball for the most part, and he's not considered a big. You could best describe him as a small forward if you really want to tag a position to him, but he absolutely has the skill set to play two guard and plays like a guard, and at times is a backcourt player. But yeah, you're not wrong what you're saying, but they'll list him as a forward. He's not a big, though. He doesn't play like a big. They don't post him up. He's a 6'9 swing guy, is the best way I would put it, that could play in the two and the three, which makes it even more impressive at that size that he has the skill set of like a 6'4 guard. Mm-hmm. But there's not many 6'4 two guards left in the NBA. They're all taller and leaner and extremely athletic. Just take that for what it's worth.
Well, it's fair. Yeah. Good point. Yeah, you had mentioned earlier about the Mike about, you know, people falling apart. I kind of stepped into John Whittle territory today and put a basically a halfway point synopsis up of South Carolina and in where they are halfway through league play, because it's very fair to me now to be able to start judging things. You mentioned Kentucky. Kentucky, people are like, oh man, look at the start they're off to. Let me correct that real quick. They're off to one of the best starts in the history of the league.
Yeah.
Like, they're one win off of being perfect halfway through the league. You can't get any better than that. And I don't, although you can look at the Wildcats certainly and make the statement, and it's very fair, that their most difficult stretch is ahead of them. And you'd be right about that, because they've got the Vols, and then they come to Columbia, and then they've got the Razorbacks, and they go to Florida, and then they've got Vandy. Like, that's very difficult. What they've gone through is Georgia at home, at Missouri, at Ole Miss, Alabama, at Auburn. Well, you know, Missouri and Auburn aren't in the postseason. Ole Miss is, you know, a bubble team trying to get in, but wouldn't be in today. Alabama certainly is in and knocking on the door of hosting, and same thing with Georgia. With that said, we can't talk out of both sides of our mouth around here and tell you how difficult the league is and then not give credit to the Wildcats for managing a 14-1 record. So I'm going to give them every ounce of credit that they deserve. They've got the second best ERA in the conference, and in league play, they have the best batting average. And they could beat you in multiple waves. So, like, I'm going to give them all the credit in the world. I think they're a real threat, and I think they can beat anybody that remains on their schedule soundly. I don't think 14-1 will uphold itself on the back end of this thing, though, with what's to come.
Yeah, I think the two most dreaded words after the Cal situation in the Kentucky vernacular are lifetime contract. I don't think that's going to happen again. But if Nick Mangione takes Kentucky to its first ever World Series, you might as well give him a lifetime contract. People have to understand just how bad Kentucky baseball was for a long, long time. He came in right out of the chute, took him to a super in year one. I think they lost to Louisville when Louisville was really at the top of their game. I've gotten to know Minge quite well over the years. He's an outstanding individual who knows the limitations of that job, how difficult it is. A couple years ago, there was a little buzz that he could get fired. He was on a hot seat. That's just the nature of the beast. And now, back-to-back quality years, I don't think he's going anywhere, and nor should he.
No, they're really freaking good. I mean, it just is what it is. And this is going to be, an incredible test when they come to town in a couple of weekends for the Gamecocks. But the Gamecocks, Mike, they're pretty good too. Here's the thing. They're back in the top 25. I'm a big D1 baseball guy, and I appreciate their rankings. They've got Carolina at 20. I think it's very fair. I'll tell you why. The metrics work in favor of Carolina. The metrics are there. They're a top 15 RPI team. They have the third most quad one wins in the country. They're 8-7 in league play in the most difficult league in the country. The conference RPI proves that. It's really, the ACC is actually a little bit of a distant second. It's not as close as you would think. And they've managed to get through this halfway point. By the way, 16-14 in this league and winning all the games that they've won in non-conference, you're a host. Like you're going to be a top 16. So they have gotten there. You've got the eyeball, like we talk about basketball, right, guys? So you've got the eyeball test, and then you got the paperwork, you got the metrics over here, you got the resume. The eyeball test is what is failing the Carolina from a ranking standpoint currently. And here's why. Because if you're watching the games, and the guys at D1 Baseball are very qualified to make any sort of judgment or determination on this group as much as anybody out there that covers the sport. Aaron Fitt is phenomenal. Kendall Rogers, those guys are really good. You get your ERAs over 6 in league play. Now, they're not the only one. ERAs are up because the strike zone sucks. We already had this conversation earlier. Mm. But their ERA is up over 6 in league play. They're hitting below 200 with the bases loaded. And they're hitting 239 with runners on base. But they're winning games. Like, so if those numbers were just a little bit better, like if you were hitting 200 with the bases loaded and like 269 with runners on base, it's you're talking about apples and oranges here. So there's an eyeball test, and then there's a resume, and those two things are not quite equal, but the resume is super. And so these next couple of weeks, like they'll come to Charleston tomorrow night. Everybody should expect them to beat the Citadel. I do. They better. And that's the only quad four team left on the schedule. And then they go home and they've got number 6 in the RPI, and then they have number 4 in the RPI. And by the way, they're off between next weekend and Kentucky. Is that good? Is that bad? Probably not great for offensive guys who are getting into a groove, but for pitchers and not having to go out there and throw a bunch of dudes in the middle of the week, probably not a bad thing either. So it probably offsets itself a little bit. But you've got an incredible. I mean, you can't ask for anything more than this. The next couple of weeks to be able to start to separate themselves and cement themselves. There's still plenty of work to do after all that, of course, but separate themselves as a real, we are a host seed. It's going to take playing our way out instead of playing our way in.
Well, then the next 6 in conference are going to go along. I mean, you can't get swept by either one of these teams. I mean, ideally you split, and then Missouri is a great opportunity to go on the road. I know it's quirky to go out there. I'd rather go out there at this time of year than early. They're not very good. Georgia at home. Georgia's good. Are they great? Should South Carolina beat them at home? Yeah. I think what you're looking for, JB, is an 11-4 second half SEC record.
Whoa.
They're 8-7 right now. They put them at 19-11.
11-4. You're going to be about the 4th seed in the tournament.
Ambitious.
Well, no, I mean, look, I mean, so 3-3, and then, well, 10-5. All right. So, because I don't have them winning the series in Knoxville. You split the next 6. Sweep Missouri, sweep Georgia, which can happen. We've seen Carolina go through tough opponents, then it lightens up and they start sweeping people. Win your non-conferences, and it's what, 18 conference wins. I mean, everybody kind of freaked out at the beginning. I think it's the eyeball test, like you mentioned, but the record's just about the same as in some of the Tanner teams that advanced pretty far.
Yeah, I think if you can find your way to 9, if you can find your way to 9 and you're 17-13, you literally, when I say you got nothing to worry about, I mean, you got nothing to worry about. You're it's everything you want. They're probably at that point in time, because if you get to nine just because of strength of schedule, you're not going to have any choice but to have so many quad one victories. You're without a doubt a top 16. You're knocking on the door of a top eight. I'll hold true what I've said before. I mean, 8-7, they're still going to be 16-14 guys. They're hosting at that. So, but to your point, JC, not to throw water on what you were saying, I didn't mean it like that. I mean, they do have nine games at home. Georgia is really, really good. Like, their RPI is 11th for a reason. Oh, they're really good.
I'm not saying they're not. I'm just saying this team has not played its best yet.
No. If they're a small smidgen more, which is basically doing what they're capable of doing, sky's the limit. I mean, I think John said it earlier, and I mentioned this too. I'd like to kind of see them settle some things down a little bit in the bullpen. Like, I felt like earlier in the year they kind of had a few more answers. Now that they've kind of changed rotation a little bit, I think they're kind of trying to find their way around that again. And they've got the guys that can do it, but they just haven't quite gotten there, but they're there. So we just gotta see them get it done. But, yeah, I mean, six SEC teams are going to host for sure. Could there be seven? Yes, there could be, but six will host. Right now, I think Carolina would be sixth of that group.
I think it'd be great to get a super.
I'll second that. It is weird. The home cooking has not gone as well as you would think. I think if you did like a 10-year case study on that and the top eight national seeds, it's not as chalkish as you would think. In other words, the home team has lost a lot more than you would think. So you don't want to set up a scenario, well, Carolina doesn't host a super. Well, you know, it was a nice run, but we'll get waxed in the super. And no. Plenty of road teams win super regionals and get to Omaha. If you play, you're playing well at the right time, you can win anywhere in baseball.
I think it gets tough when it's an SEC opponent and you have to go on the road. The last two have been Arkansas and Florida.
Of course,
Oklahoma State came to Carolina and took care of them in the supers a few years back, but, I'm with you. I mean, you know, look at what was it? Gosh, Tennessee went to Clemson's regional last year. That was unfair. And I think UNC Charlotte actually put Clemson out. But Tennessee.
Classic case of a team that underachieved in the regular season and then got over the hump, much like Florida State in their last year. And then it was like, so now you are underseeded in a way based on talent. And so that was bad news for Clemson, and then Tennessee wound up advancing. And those kind of stories, again, happen every year. Just like to go back to our conversation a week ago, there are going to be a couple of SEC teams that are riding high right now, maybe Kentucky's one, that get humbled in the second half. And then there's going to be a couple that are flying under the radar that all of a sudden figure stuff out, and they go on a run. And there's a good chance Carolina might not be either one of those. They might go 8-7 again, finish 16-14. You know, nobody knows the answer to the, like, it's not like Carolina's got a bunch of a rash of injuries and they're just waiting for guys to get healthy. And then you'll really see this team you're already at full strength, essentially. How are they all of a sudden going to, I think the schedule overall lightens up a bit compared to the first half. That was a pretty strong gauntlet first 15 for Carolina. I think, and this is kind of where JC was going. I mean, there's no gimmies in any series. It wouldn't surprise me if Missouri took a game, if Georgia took a game, but I'd rather play Missouri, Georgia than Tennessee, Arkansas. I realize Arkansas is coming up, but yeah, I mean, all those things will come into play. But I think the second half is a little lighter. And again, you hope that just guys that were slumping early figure it out. You hope that the pitching gets hot. You hope that guys that were not performing well all of a sudden do. A couple of teams, that will happen. A couple of teams will go in reverse, and then many will just kind of stay where they are. They'll be just like they were in the first half.
Baseball is an ebb and flow season, though, normally. And so I think when you look at these last 15 conference games, it's probably a good thing to have it peaked because, you know, and who would have thought this, guys? All right, so if you'd have told me Carolina's 8-7 at the midway point of the SEC, I'd be like, okay, that's cool, probably. You know, well, what's the record against Vanderbilt in Florida? 5-1.
Yeah, right.
I mean, you know, like the two, arguably two of the most best programs in the conference the last 6-7 years. Well, they're 5-1 against those cats, but, you know, Ole Miss, Alabama, A&M, Ole Miss and Alabama are 3-6. That's kind of the thing I take away from it, too, against the good teams or the more talented teams on the schedule. You know, South Carolina's played pretty well. And I just don't see a lot of these guys continuing to slump like they are. I think eventually the runners in scoring position thing will fix itself. I think everybody thought Kingston was crazy for putting Messina at the top of the lineup, but lo and behold, there you go. And didn't John Whittle say the other day Messina's one of the fastest players on the team?
Yeah, he is. True? Yeah.
He can run? That's
crazy. Well, I mean, you know, I sent y'all a screenshot this weekend of what I had sent Whittle last week, and I'm literally just laughing during the game. I'm like, you see, it's really not that difficult. You do these two things, and this is what will happen. And that's what good baseball teams do. They do those things, and they did. If they continue to do that, they're going to win a bunch of games.
Jamie's being modest. He absolutely nailed it. Like, he absolutely.
I didn't get a screenshot. Like,
had the prescription.
Am I not special? I don't think so.
He was the doctor. He was the prescription. He wrote it in Latin.
Yeah,
dum daro porici manato carata. It came down from God to goes from God to Bradford to Tommy Lasorda. Well, I guess it had to go to Lasorda before Bradford now, but God to Tommy Lasorda to Bradford to the staff, and then Messina's ripping the cover off the ball as a leadoff hitter, and
right, yeah,
it runs like a gazelle out there, fastest running catcher.
What I had said was, they've got to get back to hitting the ball back up the middle in hitters counts and seeing multiple pitches with two strikes. Like, essentially what I was saying was, quit trying to do too much when you've got a favorable count and don't go down easy. Battle. Put the ball in play.
Yeah.
And this weekend, you know, they did a lot of that. They were multiple times driving the ball back up the middle. When you do that, you're going to hit gaps. It's going to happen. I mean, everybody knows that. If you're a baseball guy, you get it. You know, if your focus is on hitting the ball back up the middle, just from a timing standpoint, you're going to drive the ball out of the yard and you're going to hit the ball into the gaps. That's the way it works. And then if you just battle with two strikes and put pressure on somebody, at some point in time, you're going to get a mistake. And that happened a lot this weekend, and that they were able to capitalize on that.
Florida, something's up at Florida right now.
They're just not good. That's what's up. They're not good. They're probably not going to the postseason.
Yesterday, you saw what they're capable of if they get clicking.
I mean, yeah.
They have players on paper. Their defense wasn't that good. They didn't play very – I mean, yesterday, they kind of got up off the mat on Saturday and got some momentum back. But, yeah, they just don't look very – that looks nothing like the Florida team.
You know what they look like? They look like a team that came into the season that was relying on like three players. Like, no problem. Caglione will get it done. And then everybody else is like, well, you know, he only hits once through the lineup, right? Like, you have to go eight players and he's going to get to hit again. Like, one of y'all's going to have to do something.
I have to laugh because in addition to these shows, which I love doing, I go on once a week on a Georgia show and I go on once a week on a Florida show. And on the Florida show, there's a chat box just like we have here. And there are people ripping O'Sullivan.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah. Just like, you're not doing this, you're not doing that. Like, dude, do you remember what you were before Sully?
Yeah, terrible.
You weren't winning a lot of championships, you know? You just weren't. But what happened was he goes right out of the gate, and they're like going to Omaha every year, like 5 years in a row. And of course, they finally get over the hump and win one national championship, which hadn't been done. And so now they're not as dominating. Yeah. Whatever formula, whatever buttons he was pushing, I mean, they're still getting some studs in there, but they're not as dominating as years past. And it just made the national championship series. But But they think it's their birthright now to go to Omaha every year. Much like, does it sound like a familiar fan base guy?
The rest of the SEC?
A lot of it.
What do you think people are saying in Baton Rouge right now? They're 3-12 in the league.
What do you think they're saying in Oxford? They're saying, I told you we should have fired Bianchi. Okay, he won a national title, but look at what he's done 5 out of the last 6 years. Fire his ass. Like, that's where
they
are.
Let Kim Mulkey coach the baseball team.
Kim Mulkey.
Right. I bet she'll do better.
She'll wear a peacock hat instead of a ball cap, but we need that around here.
Need that kind of pageantry. It's LSU. Cajun. All wide.
It's intimidating. Okay. You I'm wear gonna say one of
this
them
right now. If Kimball can coach in baseball, we go 56-0 every year.
Yeah.
Kimball, she's never gonna lose. She's not a loser. Go Tigers.
Yes,
he's seen. Yeah. All right, so I gotta answer Jan. Somebody's got I can't answer because I don't know.
Oh, sure. Yeah, the shift. Yeah,
this shift thing, it's very interesting to me. And it's one of the few times I'm looking forward to hearing. Not that I don't look forward to your answers, but you know, I'm like, I'm a fan.
Yeah.
And you're waiting for what you guys.
One of the few times I want to hear you speak.
I'm like, I would turn on the radio for this.
I'll shut up. And listen.
Yeah. He's going to hang up and listen to the call off air.
Yeah.
I'll hang up and listen. Enjoy what you do, except for you, Jamie, 90% of the time.
Yeah, man, you'll do a great job, but
pretty much
Jamie,
bad.
It's one of the few times I really give a damn what you've got to say to it. I tell you what we'll do. We got to hit a timeout, so we'll hit a timeout, and then I'll make JC's week when we return right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
I said, oh, Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barndo Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let a Big Ten stop. And originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of the heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring, and they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, in which is today Bourbon County.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville, Mount Pleasant, Myrtle Beach, in Bluffton, and online at palmcasual.com for our products and out-of-state locations. Gamecock owned and operated.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barndo Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned, Gamecock operated.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks!
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
What's up to the best fans in the country? This is Eli Jones, and you're tuned in to Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Go Cocks.
At 1:45, just to let all three of you know, we'll be doing burgers on the grill tonight, sitting on our very comfortable Palm Casual furniture. So thanks to Aaron and the team at Palm Casual for making our backyard the place to be. Spring, summer, fall, winter too, but it's they can't control the weather. But, you know, winter in South Carolina could be 70. So we're very happy to have a place we like to spend time in out there.
Are we invited?
You're always invited. You and Summer can come anytime. We have plenty of room. All right. The rule in our house is, just to kind of, you know, we like to throw folks right into the fire. So your first morning here, you will be woken up by our kids right around 6:30. We will, though, supply breakfast, but you will have to get up at 6:30 and do a puzzle or maybe shoot some basketball with them.
Well, I'm up for that.
Yeah, you know, something like that. And then after that, day two, you can sleep in all you want.
Okay. Summer's great with the kids. I'll hoop it up with them.
Yeah. Or you can just tell them what I tell them, like, get the hell out of here.
Yeah, get out of here.
You know, no.
I'm chilling on the Palm Casual patio furniture. I don't have time for your games right now. So.
Honestly, I've thought about sleeping out there a couple of times because then they won't be able to find me.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. Yeah, how effective would sleeping on the furniture be out there?
You'll only find mom, and that's what I'm I'm more after that. So
how many locations for that Palm Casual?
Four in South Carolina. Yeah, Myrtle Beach, Bluffton, Somerville, Mount Pleasant. But
love it.
People come from everywhere for a reason. Number one, they're Gamecock owned and operated, but the 30-day guarantee is what gets them. Real quick on the shift. So I'm a believer in the shift. It gets exposed when it doesn't work well. Everybody blames the shift. I would remind, and this isn't directed at Jan specifically. That's what Jan's my guy. I love Jan. Carolina would have lost the game Saturday had it not been for the shift. So, you know, Jack Caglione hit right into it twice. Their numbers, Monty's the shift guy for Carolina. Their numbers on that are unreal. Used to not be a huge believer in it, but they've since then really kind of increased how they do it as far as the information that they use. And so that one or two that get through the shift that burn you, generally because it's a negative world, that takes over the conversation.
Right, right.
But the other eight times, nobody talks about it because it worked out.
I couldn't agree more. And that's why do you think they outlawed it in Major League Baseball? Because it's that damn effective. It was really too effective. So if it's playing mind tricks on Major League hitters, what do you think it's doing to college kids?
Right.
But they're not outlawing it in college baseball anytime soon. So I'm all for it. I mean, I've worked for years with Todd Walker, who is a Hall of Fame college baseball player, played 15 years in the bigs. And every time we work together, he hates the shift. I think because deep down he knows he would have hated when he had to face it.
Yeah.
And so when a guy
hates it too. Hates
yeah.
It.
When a guy hits against the shift and gets a base hit, I know exactly what Todd's going to say. Well, there it is, Mike. Another case where the shift burns a pitching and a defense. But I'm with you. For more often than not, tendencies work in baseball. We don't live in a day and time where guys go out of their way to choke up and go the opposite way or drop down a bunt. Guys just they're one trick ponies. I mean, I hate to put it that bluntly.
Yeah.
You know, they might make adjustments somewhat, but not that dramatically. That just there's not many of those guys left in
the
college game.
There's not a shift on every single hitter. I mean, there might be you might shade a guy on hitters, but that's been around for years.
Sure.
I mean, for decades.
And that's still legal in the bigs, too. You can shade. You can shade.
Yeah, that's always been here. You know, but if every single hitter was shifted, I mean, the guys, that, as you just pointed out, the guys that can, you know, that swing the bat well, that can make a bunch of adjustments, they're not seeing all that stuff. So it's the guys offensively, like if you're a one or two dimensional hitter and they shift it against you, I'm sorry, but that's on you.
I agree. But I mean, like you take a guy like Freddie Freeman can hit the ball anywhere. He's a machine.
Yeah.
But most guys, even at the big league level, particularly lefties that are just dead pull hitters, they don't make the adjustments. And offense was already suffering in Major League Baseball. Strikeouts were up, offense was down. I agree with almost every change that they made. The bags being bigger, bringing stolen bases back in, the pitch clock, although now you have a lot of major league arms that you have players saying the reason why injuries are up on pitchers is because they're being forced to throw the ball to the plate quicker. So less recovery. Now, I don't know what the science is behind that. I honestly think the bigger factor is, and I've talked to several former major leaguers on this, is that it's simply everybody is maxing out on far too many pitches. These kids grow up in travel ball throwing too many pitches, and then they get to the higher levels, and they all just pitch to the radar gun. Every ballpark now in college, with few exceptions, if I want to find what my velo was on the pitch, I can look at the scoreboard and find it.
Yeah.
Right. If I don't have it, I'm going to go back to the dugout. I'm going to get it. They are obsessed with it because they know the scouts are obsessed with it. So you're going max, 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 max. And the arm is just not built that way. The best analogy I heard was we now are in a time in pitching where it's like you have a souped up engine. You've never had a stronger engine, but you've got the same chassis in the car. The car can't handle that much speed. And so the car is fishtailing and it's out of control. I'm afraid that this is not getting any better anytime soon. You know, we mentioned Strider in the last hour. Well, that's the second time now. So I don't know if he's ever going to be the same. It's not uncommon to go to a college staff and look at the dozen or so pitchers, and over half of them have already had Tommy John, and they're like 20 years old. If this was any other sport and any other situations, there'd be more of a battle cry. Like, we've got to do something to change this.
Yeah.
But nothing's done. Nothing's done. We just keep having them pitch in the red. We're a race car in the red, to use a Pulp Fiction line.
I'm with you. I'd cut it off, by the way. I'd cut the gun off on the board. So what? Because I want to know how hard he's throwing. Who cares?
And I'll say
about that. They aren't going to come to the game because of it? No.
No. And I'll admit, as an announcer, it helps me if I know what the velo is. You know, we're not exactly right there at home plate, so it helps identifying pitches. It helps knowing if a guy's running out of gas. I mean, I think we're just at a point in time now at major league parks and some college. It's not just the velo. It tells you fastball.
Spin rate,
launch angle. I mean, everything. We are in a day and age of where the analytics, you don't have to go to the website to get it. It's on the scoreboard, and fans have gotten used to that, and they want it. They expect it. So I don't know if it's by the way, the baseball bunch. Yes, Craig, I watched it when I was a kid. I preferred This Week in Baseball with Mel Allen. The baseball bunch was kind of a hokey show for kids with the chicken and Johnny Bench. And yeah, Lasorda was on it from time to time. I was a weird kid. I wasn't watching cartoons. I'd go home and watch This Week in the NFL or NFL's Greatest Films when I was like seven. So I liked the more professional show, like This Week in Baseball and some of those. But if you like, you know, good old fashioned kid fun with a chicken, then yeah, This Week in Baseball was your call. Those are tough decisions we all had to make as kids. Another one you have to make is finding the right insurance agent. Let me suggest Gary Patterson of State Farm. Speaking of South Carolinians, a long time in Lugolf. If you're in the Midlands, from Lugolf to Columbia, Lexington to Camden to Blythewood, he's your guy. He's been my guy for over 20 years. And again, I've had great experiences through Gary, and I've had nightmare experiences through other companies. But with State Farm agent Gary Patterson, it's easy to make the right choice. So just call him today. See the number on your screen for our vast YouTube audience, or you can go to GaryPatterson.net for more information.
It's 1:53, so we are set to get out of here in just a little bit. Somebody's calling me. Let's see. Oh, potential spam. Probably want another cruise. I've had some guy calling me for like 3 weeks. I've told him 15 times. He keeps wanting me to make a payment on my shed. I'm like, dude, I don't own a shed. So you got the wrong number. He keeps calling.
Wanting to sell me solar panels, which somebody out there in the closing 7 minutes of our show, can you hit me up in chat row? Is it worth getting solar panels? Good and bad. I need to know. Okay.
Not where you live, Mike, in the woods. You're not going to be able to generate enough power.
Well, it's got to be sun. How much sunlight does your roof get?
There's a certain part of it that actually gets a lot. Mm-hmm. There's a certain part of it because I have the utility bills to prove it. The sun beats down the near the creek. JC's been to my Atlanta home. Near the creek, you could justify it. Mm-hmm. And it's like $30,000 paid over 25 years with a $9,000 tax credit. But I just feel like there's some fine print there. Mm. You know, they sell you on eventually you have like no utility bill. You're paying zero. Wow.
That's funny. We got a guy in our HOA who comes to the meetings every year and complains about it because he was like, you don't understand how much structural integrity the roof gives when you put all that weight on top of it and add all those holes. You should hear, of course, he's, you know, 70 years old and has been Christian all
structural
life.
Integrity.
Everything. Yeah.
Structural integrity.
Structural
integrity. Will the Gamecock offensive line have structural integrity this year, JC? People want to know.
Yeah, at some point,
is it more structural integrity than a blazing fastballer?
Yeah, I Yeah, no kidding on that. Now, I kind of spent the weekend chopping up some clips from the show and spent a lot of time with what John Strickland was saying last week. And it makes sense because it's like, you know, you got a lot of new players, you got a lot of young players, you're putting in a new run game. There's going to be a lot of assignment errors and things of that nature. And my understanding was that first scrimmage, that was part of the reason they look so bad. Plus, you're trying to find your best five, you're plugging and playing guys. And then you look on the other side of the ball, and there's a lot of veterans that have been at South Carolina for a while, and then a lot of guys that transferred in that have played 2, 3, 4 years of college football. Mm-hmm. It's got to be kind of a tough matchup, I think, you know. I mean, if you put it in perspective, but yes, they have to get better up front. And I can't answer that with any kind of certainty, except if they avoid injuries, there's no excuse why they can't be better than last year, which I don't know where that gets you, because it was rock bottom almost last season. So there you go. I don't want to put solar panels on my roof because the governor wants to. He's all about solar, you know, and I hate him. So I'm just assumed double down on the natural gas.
I think your mayor, the way he would weigh it is, well, how would that help the criminals that rob and shoot people in various parts of Chicago? If so, he's all for it, and have the government pay for it. It looks like solar panels, according to Quantrell, Charles, Clint, they're all anti-solar panels. So I'm going to have them talk to this sales guy.
Ashley said he's convinced that those are the same people that sold rainbow vacuums.
Rainbow vacuums.
I inherited a rainbow, and it works very well. My little R2 unit, it does a very good job. But, you know, if you just want to kill that hot spot on your roof, Mike, it'd probably be a lot cheaper just to plant a big-ass tree.
It would take quite a few of them.
Mike's got big trees as it is, though.
Yeah, it's just the angle that there's, once 1 o'clock on hits, that side of the house just gets melted. It would take more than one tree. It would take a family of sequoias to block that out. And I'm not prepared to purchase a family of sequoias.
Oh, man.
Hey, can I mention real quick, JC mentioned earlier, we've had from Josh Pate to Ross Dellinger to Andy Staples to Tom Luganville to Barrett Salee to
Tim Brando. I know
Dan Wetzel, Tim Brando. We've been on the national pundit fire stream. Back tomorrow morning live. For those of you on the Chief Sports app, you'll get the handy dandy reminder. We'll start at around 9:15. Wheels up at 9:20. And at 10 o'clock, Mike Griffith will join us. Now, who is Mike Griffith? If you watch Fox, you've probably seen him on there a lot. He covers Georgia, used to cover Tennessee. And he's very controversial, I would say. I mean, Feinbaum and the fans there, they grill him all the time. But I like him. I think he does a good job. He covers the sport well. He's very opinionated. And, of course, he's been covering the most successful program over the last, I don't know, take your time frame pick, 5 years, 10 years, whatever, in Georgia. So he'll be on, and we'll talk some big picture stuff with him as well, but that'll be on tomorrow's JC and Morgan as in addition to the award-winning JC5.
Exactly. And Quantrell, you, when we had Wetzel, and you're like somebody from outside of the South. Griffith has spent his career in the South.
Yes.
Georgia, covered Tennessee and Georgia. He's a Michigan guy. He's a Michigan State graduate.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So he's what we call a Yankee down south. He's from the Midwest.
He doesn't sound very Yankee.
He had me on his show one time. But we
okay.
I know him a little bit. I know Mike. Yeah. Maybe he called and interviewed me for a newspaper article or something. I don't know. But really good writer, and it's really good to have him on. Is he on with – yeah, he's on with Bill King weekly like I am. So he's part of the – it's part of the Bill King Club out of Nashville.
JC, what do you think is going to happen with this Lenoris Sellers? He's good, but he doesn't have the experience, does he?
I love Bill.
Bill's classic.
There is an episode with Bill King on JC.
Yes.
What we call Evergreen.
If you folks out there can think of somebody we haven't had on that you want on, let me know. Let me know. We've had a heck of a cavalcade of
had a run. Guests.
Yeah, we've had a good run. And then you hear JC and I babbling as well. But I like to think of it as good babble.
Good babble.
Insightful babble.
Yeah.
Measured babble. Consider
upper Midwesterners Yankees.
Not really.
My dad thought they were.
I don't know.
I don't look around here and go, you're a bunch of Yankees. A bunch of y'all.
Ohio and West. I think you kind of dropped that.
Ray Tanna let the Yankees come down here and take over our school. That Mark Kingston, he is not a Southern man.
By the way, speaking of Coach Kingston, he's going to join us later on in the week.
Hey!
That's
awesome. Yeah, Charles Power would be good to have, old J.C. Morgan Krieger says. That's good to have King back on, too. I'm glad we get him, after a 4-1 week.
Regardless of the record, the whole thing was to get him on after halfway through the regular or the league play.
I know, but I still like that. I still like to talk to people when they're kind of on a little more chipper, you know. It just makes my job.
Oh, he's always chipper for us.
Amen.
Looking forward to that.
All right. I'll have to load up my new edition in the music there.
Yeah. Get new edition ready.
My new edition ready.
Mr. Telephone Man. That's a dimer.
Yeah. I'm not gonna let him get off of that new edition thing. That was pretty poor.
No, it was too good.
Dang, bad taste of music, man. Yeah. Speaking of Yankees,
what Christmas music do you listen to? Well, I like the New Edition Christmas album.
New Edition. I was like, geez, do you listen to Wham too, Mark?
I got one already in there.
Man, come on, Wham. Mm-mm. There's Mm-mm. some Wham that I can get behind, right?
Yeah, but not Last Christmas.
No, never.
You see the documentary on him on George Michael? I think it's on Netflix.
No.
I learned a lot.
Yeah,
it actually
I'm
is
never
going to
dance again.
My wife is thrilled with me.
You've got no rhythm.
That's right.
Yeah. My wife was thrilled with me because I taught my 5-year-old girls to change the words from Last Christmas I Gave You My Heart to Last Christmas I Gave You My Fart.
Okay.
I put it in a stocking for you. Here you go. Oh, sniff it.
Carrie
away.
Was like, you got to be kidding me. I was
Yuletide.
Like, what do you mean?
There's a Yuletide log in there for you too, Daddy.
All right. For
Andrew Ridgely, that's the other guy from Web. Michael Haney reminded me the other day in a conversation when I moved companies, because the Gamecocks moved companies in Columbia, so I had to move with them if I was going to keep calling games. They partnered me up with Jay Phillips. I didn't know this guy from Adam. He had never done sports talk radio, and Michael was producing, and he reminded me that I used to call him the other guy from Wham, the Pat Sajak of sports talk radio, and Rosie O'Donnell's personal hairdresser.
Oh gosh.
We had fun. You know, I mean,
that's fun. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just fun. I don't know if he found it funny, but damn if I didn't.
I mean, you know, right. Sometimes the target is not the intended audience. You know.
Yeah. I'm sure. Yeah. It was a very interesting growing process.
We should probably go.
Personal hairdresser. We should be the other guy from Wham and the Pat Sajak of Sports Talk Radio.
Or Mad Dog's mustache. The golden tones of Mike Morgan. Titanic's biggest fan, JC Sherbert.
Oh, and talk Titanic.
Whittle. We'll be back tomorrow.
It was National Titanic for Remembrance. Yeah. Remembrance Day.
Yeah.
So there you go, Jack. Frozen Jack.
Hale will be here tomorrow.
I'll never let go. I'll never let
ever forget.
We figured that out. Hale will join us tomorrow with a full. I'm having a hard time thinking about what I'm about to say with this cat in my ear. Hale will have a full scoop on the weekend recruiting efforts of the Gamecocks at the spring game. We got to go. Bye. See you tomorrow.